Well, hello, friends. Welcome one and welcome all. I can't offer much in this outdoor hall, but sit here and rest. You must be weary, and I'll share with you Tales of Tyria. This week on Tales of Tyria, we've got huge discussion, guys, the patch notes, kind of, and a discussion on hardware for your gaming PC. It's all coming right up. Stay tuned. Yes, welcome one, welcome all, welcome to, well, everybody we've got here. We've got a whole group in for today. We're talking about gaming hardware on this episode. But before we get there, let's introduce everyone. This is the Tales of Tyria Guild Wars 2 show. You can find us on the web at talesoftyria.com. You can find the show notes there. So if we talk about a link or if we're talking about some kind of a video or anything like that, you can find that in the show notes. So that is on talesoftyria.com. Or if you're watching this on YouTube, check the description for the video itself. I am Bridger. I'll be your host for today. Glad you got a hold of the program, however you may have found it. Tell a friend or two, won't you? And if you guys would drop on iTunes and leave us a review of the podcast there, that would help us out. Positive, negative, whatever. We'd like to hear your thoughts on the show. And right now, for some reason, we're 17th in the list of podcasts when you search for Guild Wars 2, even though the vast majority of those have nothing to do with Guild Wars 2. They're generic MMO podcasts, somehow are still ahead of us. When you search Guild Wars 2, you get something like The Instance for some reason. I don't know. Anyway, let's move on. I am Bridger, as I said again. Let me introduce everyone around the table here. Aku is here with us. Welcome, Aku. Haven't seen you in a while.
Yeah, it's glad to be back. What's going on, guys?
Not much. So you're here to tell us about the Nostromo, yeah?
Yes, I'm a huge advocate for that piece of hardware. I've been using it for God knows how long, and yeah.
All right, we're going to get to that in just a minute. Also, joining us here, Freelancer. Welcome, sir.
How's it going, Bridger?
And you are our internal hardware guru. You helped me build my PC, so I'm hoping we can get your insight.
A lot of guys, a lot of TL members get their frame rates up.
All right, so we'll get into that a little bit later. Also joining us, Gigawatt. Welcome, sir. I haven't seen you in a while either, but the power symbol has morphed into a human face.
Cheerio.
And also Vega, who's here to represent the keyboarded among us.
Good evening. Wait, I am? Oh, no. I was just here to bash Nostromo.
You're not here to advocate for the keyboard, just to say how terrible the Nostromo is. That's okay. I'll talk about the keyboard. All right, so let's jump right into it, shall we? Last week we talked about the Holy Trinity, and our question of the week was, is the Holy Trinity dead, truly, after having played the beta weekend? And we had a lot of different discussions about that. Vegan Freelancer disagreed fairly adamantly. There's the word I was looking for. And we had sort of a lot of mixed feedback. Some people said, I agree with Vega. Some people said, Freelancer's right.
But ultimately, I won.
Some agreed with both.
Some agreed with both.
But whenever they agreed with both, they always agreed with me first. So.
Well, that's one way to have a moral victory. So a lot of it actually came down to definition. I mean, can we nail down, let's ask you, Freelancer, when we say Holy Trinity, what are we talking about? What is your definition?
Yeah, one of the, I think you actually have it, that one feedback where they were just talking about the definition of it. He had a good point there. You know, there is no real definition of it, but I guess what we all know from WoW is that the Holy Trinity is a dedicated tank, a dedicated element, you know, or listen to me, elementals, dedicated DPS, and a dedicated healer. And when he was wording it in that email, I almost agreed with him because in that sense, Guild Wars 2 does not have a Holy Trinity. But then I still disagree with Vega, sorry, you know, that classes could do anything because that's just a load of crap. But yeah.
All right. You may hear some weird screaming and yelling. We've relocated next to a torture chamber. That is temporary housing for the podcast studio. Please disregard anything you hear on the podcast. So one of the things...
It's not even coming from my house.
Yeah, I know. he's hearing it in his head. Where is it? It's around. It's all around me. All right. So the definition that I've always came up with is if for the Holy Trinity to be as we all understand it, it's somebody whose job it is to tank the boss for the entire encounter, or maybe to switch off with a single off tank maybe at some point, and somebody whose job it is to heal the party. And they're doing just healing or just tanking, really. They're mostly worried about aggro mechanics, or they're mostly worried about healing. If the people are doing those roles, but they're switching in and out of them, and they're doing more than just, like, if you have somebody who's a support character who throws down a healing geyser, you know, like an elementalist, but then is also switching into fire attunement and throwing fireballs and trying to use control spells to keep the enemy back as well, then I think in that case, the Trinity would be broken. So with that definition, you know, like Freelancer said, if people are locked into singular roles that they're doing for the entire fight versus people that are doing multiple roles but maybe specializing and focusing on one more than the other. Aku, Giga, you guys weren't here last week. Why don't you guys weigh in on that? Don't all scramble to go first.
Well, the way I thought was you clearly had leaders in specific roles. Maybe you have, you know, a global condition breaker on this class and you also have it on the other class, but one of them is clearly better. There's always ways you can optimize. It's cool that you have options, especially in PvE. I see that as being having a lot more freedom. Whereas if you're in PvP and your opponent's using the optimal best setup, you don't have any choice but to just match that. You do anything less than you're behind. So in PvE, I think it gives a lot more freedom, but in PvP, you're getting more into having your theory crafted out, cookie cutters, as it were. You can't really get away from it altogether.
Raku, any different thoughts?
I actually kind of agree. I mean, in PvE, you kind of can just kind of, more or less, in a certain aspect, kind of face roll your way to victory. Whereas in PvP, there are going to be specs that beat other specs. And, you know, many times there's going to be math that proves that and backs that up. So, I mean, you know, what Giga said, I completely agree with.
So the best feedback that I saw, and we got a lot of different things on this topic, so there was a lot of good, you know, feedback. So I'm not trying to say that, you know, this is the only one of substance and that's why we put it in the show, but we're trying to keep the feedback to a five or so minutes thing each week. Weird One says, quote, "The Holy Trinity, in my mind, is a rigid structure made up of three roles. A person in role X does actions that support X. A healer in WoW mixes damage spells into the rotation is going to wipe the party. A tank that falls back and starts firing ranged DPS at the boss is going to wipe the party. Yet in the Guild Wars 2 Catacombs videos I've seen, this is exactly what happens. If you freeze one of the videos at any moment in the battle, you could try to point to player X who's getting hit and call him the tank. Player Y in the back who just dropped a healing well could be the healer. But then you play the video forward a few seconds and now everyone's doing something else. That's why there is no Holy Trinity. Everyone is everything. A given class might be a little better at taking a hit, but that doesn't make them a tank. It makes them tanky. They still have no means to pull mobs off of other players, nor can they simply stand there and take hit after hit. I think parties in WoW are made up of tanks, healers, and DPS. I think parties in Guild Wars 2 are made up of adventurers. Each individual is a force to be reckoned with on their own." Unquote. I think I agree with what he's saying there, but we do have to, with the caveat of what Freelancer is saying, that yes, there will be people that are specialized, and if you try to go against the specialization, like if you try to make a DPS guardian, people are going to laugh at you, I think.
Bottom line is the Trinity is dead. If you get rid of all the gray area, there's no taunting, there's no direct healing, per se, so the Trinity is dead. It's evolved into...
with me.
that was my point all along, is the Trinity's dead. There's no healer, there's no tank, so therefore the Trinity is dead. You take out all the gray area and it's still dead.
All right.
Just because you have classes that are doing multiple things doesn't mean it's still a Trinity.
Yeah, I think under that definition, I think the Trinity is dead. I think there will still be plenty of specialization, and people that think there won't be min-maxing in Guild Wars 2 are probably kidding themselves. I think that's the ultimate takeaway here, is that the Trinity as we know it is probably dead, but min-maxing will still exist, and to defeat the hardest content, you're probably going to need specific sets of characters in specific roles. You're probably going to need either a guardian or an elementalist as support, or you're going to need, you know, a warrior or a guardian in a tank-like role or something like that. So we'll see how it actually shakes down. All right. A couple of new ArenaNet blogs this week. This one was really cool. Did you guys read the Amerith blog?
I did.
Tell us about that, Vega.
So pretty much there was a girl who was so inspired by video gaming and Guild Wars in general that she decided to take her own epic adventure and walk across the country. And so she walked from Maine to San Diego, and then she went up to see ArenaNet and I guess kind of tell them how much she loved Guild Wars, and they were so inspired that they made her a little character in Guild Wars 2, which I think is really cool.
Absolutely.
And I'm very surprised that she was able to do it with her dog, because I actually had a friend who did the same thing. He walked from New York to Oregon, but he obviously just did it alone. But I would imagine it'd be even harder trying to do it with a dog, because then that's two things you gotta kind of worry about. But
I don't know. You might get more sympathy if you have a cute dog.
Yeah, that's true. But I mean, you know, because all the experiences that he told me about, it really is. It's such like a real adventure that you can't really get from doing anything else. And it takes a long time. I think it took him like 6 months or something like that, maybe a little bit less.
Just hitchhiking and walking and forest gumping his way.
Yeah, he just walked. And I mean, it was kind of surprising how nice people are. You kind of forget how kind certain people can be. So yeah, it's really interesting. And then to see that someone did that and, you know, to have the dedication to be like, oh, I'm in San Diego, let me just go walk for another month up to see ArenaNet.
Well, the resources, first of all, you probably have to have a certain amount of resources to get started on that kind of a journey.
But the investment.
Backpacking across Europe, as it were. I would love, and I think I saw some comments on this story, and I would love to see it happen if they actually had this character, like, physically walk across Tyria, and you could like follow Amerith on her journey, and you just have like Forrest Gump, just like everybody just running behind her as she's going from like the top of the Nord area down to the towards Orr or whatever, and then she just has this programmed path that she goes, and you just follow her, and maybe when she goes to different places she'll tell you different things about what she's learned, and I don't know, I just see that would be a really cool thing. But right now I think you can see her in the Black Citadel, if I'm not mistaken. So that's really cool. Check out the rest of that blog. And by the way, she has a blog basically that tells the story of her journey, where while she was traveling, she was blogging about everything that was happening to her. So that's a really cool thing. Definitely check that out. Highly recommend it. There's another blog here about name reservation. We didn't learn too much more than we already knew. Basically, it talks about how if you have a Guild Wars 1 character and you want it to work in Guild Wars 2 and have it reserved for you, you basically need to go and make sure that character was played sometime this year, 2012. And then in the 3-day head start, you have to make a character with that name. After the 3-day head start, you lose reservation of the name. So that's pretty much all we needed to know. Let's jump right into the thing that everybody has been talking about the last couple of days here. These patch notes. Dun, dun, dun. This is very interesting. Let's just sort of jump right in. This is a link that was on Reddit, and it came from where else? 4chan. And it could be a troll. Let's not rule out the fact that this could be a troll. But if it is, it's an extremely elaborate troll. Because, I mean, look at, just keep scrolling down.
That's a lot of work.
Scrolling down. There's a lot of work into this. They could have trolled with a lot less work and still gotten the same thing done. So, all right, Freelancer's taking a break from us here for a minute. That's okay. And we'll just discuss the patch notes here. And so there's a couple of things I really wanted to talk about. First of all, local chat. /say has now been, and that basically has a range of 2,000 units or so, which I think is about double the range of the longest range spells, if you think about it that way. Like, you know, the longest range elementalist spells, the longest range warrior shots with a bow or with a rifle are about 1,200, so 2,000 is about double that, if you think about it that way. So that's a nice little local area if you're talking to people that are around you. And then map chat or /shout, or theoretically, I think later on in this, it says slash say and slash local are two very close range. Slash shout or slash yell or slash map will be map wide. Does that make sense? Yes?
Yes.
Yeah.
So there's now two things that you can use in within your map. It's either really close to you or map wide. There's not really anything in between that, but that's okay. We're still a little bit closer. Here, input binding, there are now distinct left and right shift keys. And a lot of people see that and go, yes, shift modifiers! But I don't think that's what it is. I think it means left shift and right shift are two separate buttons as far as the game is concerned. So, nah, still
they're
no shift
there.
Modifiers.
They're, yeah. They're getting there.
They're paying attention to the shift button, and they're understanding that it works. So, who knows? Now, here's one we knew was coming because they talked about it in their wrap-up. Gadgets slash turrets now have a concept of authorita. That basically means that players that place down siege blueprints can kick out other players who are in their siege weapons if the originating player wants to use them. That's good. That's something we talked about. Trait tiers are in. Now, this is one we're going to talk about for a little bit here because this was expanded upon in the 4chan post and was described as such. There are now three tiers. I mean, there have already been three tiers of traits, right? You have the first, second, and third, and you had to buy those books. Hey, unless you have something to say, keep your mouth shut. So you have those three books that you have to buy. And the idea, beak shut. He makes a good point. So, yeah, that's better. So the first major trait, when you get the first 10 points into there, that will actually allow you to only choose from four different traits, okay? And then once you get to the second major trait, that one will allow you to choose from any of the first four or another set of four, and then the last major trait will open up all 12 available. Obviously, if you've used ones in the previous section, then you can't use them twice, but this makes it very different than what we originally had, which was, you know, I put 30 points into air, 30 points into earth, and maybe 10 points into fire. And even though I only put 10 points into fire, I can still choose any major trait I want, which was really kind of nice because it didn't make you feel like, well, I have to put everything up to 30 because that's the only way to get the good traits, quote unquote. Just like in World of Warcraft, you have to go all the way down to 31 or 21 or wherever the, you know, those sort of milestones were for the best talents. And those were really annoying to me. Like, it felt like there was no, it was like, it, just like in League, it's like 21-9-0 or 0-9-21 or 0-21-9. It's like, those are the only ways that you can do traits. And now it feels like that's kind of going to be the same thing. Gigawatt, I know you had some strong feelings about this.
Yes. Oh, God, yes. Been arguing people on TeamSpeak already. Ever since I saw that thing,
I saw Twitter was taking out your rage again. The internet must know.
I had to vent it because it was too much coming in to fit in a TeamSpeak channel. I think was the issue. But oh, it's just limiting choices, linear progression, linear power progression in a build system, which is supposed to be a playstyle customization system, is always bad. It's always bad. You should have linearity removed from the equation as much as possible. In my opinion, the fact that these traits were freeform was like the strongest point that their trait system had. Like, it was my favorite thing. It's the best thing about it. I don't know why they would want to change that. I mean, I understand from a balancing perspective, if you have less options, it's easier to balance. But honestly, I think that's just lazy development. I think you can balance it fine. Why, just getting creative and actually making all the traits good and balanced and equally powerful, instead of just like taking a cop out and, you know, narrowing the fields to get more cookie cutter builds that are really easy to optimize out. So I'm not a fan.
So Miane in the chat's bringing up the fact that essentially you no longer get the best traits out of having only 10 points into a line, which in a result from that is there's going to be like that one trait in every line that if you put 10 points into it, everybody's like must have. Like, you, oh yeah, and by the way, if you're playing the Elementalist, always put 10 points into Earth and get this thing, because it's always going to be, you know, it's always worth it because it's like the best trait in the line, whereas this you have to establish further into the line. I don't know. I still really like the concept of, you know, 10 even 10 points into a line really gets you anything that you want, and that further into the line gives you more options to synergize multiple traits together. I don't know. I'm kind of with Gigawatt on this.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of this. I mean, you know, coming from a builder standpoint, it's like, all right, I'm playing a necromancer. I need to put 10 points into this certain trait line to get, you know, 50% duration decrease on my lich form, or excuse me, my plague form, whatever the cool black move is. But the thing is, it's like, I already put a good amount of dedication into this trait line. I should be able to still take something, you know, something decent. You know, now I have to take, you know, as Giga was saying earlier, oh, 50 power. It's like, great, you know. Now I have to take these crappy traits.
The gimp traits. Everybody's like, oh, why am I going to take those stupid traits?
Yeah, I completely disagree with what they're doing with this, and hopefully they're, I don't know, hopefully they think about something else, or I don't know. So. Yeah, really.
When I was trying to look at it, trying to look at it from their perspective as to why they would do this, you know, for balancing reasons or what have you, I didn't think that there were any real trait skills that were that powerful that if you just put 10 points in, you got that one,
but you know
that
what?
all of a sudden you're now like unbeatable, or
I agree.
You know, something that strong.
But there were traits that you kind of went like, why would I ever
there's definitely
and now
traits.
Those are the ones that are going to be stuck at that 10. Like, yeah, you got to pick one of these ones that you never would have picked otherwise.
I mean, I think if they are going to keep this system, they should at least have it that if you invest the points to go to 30, that at that point, at least you're like all your traits now, you could put wherever you want. You're not limited to just those four for the first and then, you know, the next four for the second. At least if you get to 30, they should at least open them all up so that you can have more builds. Because essentially what they're doing is they're cutting the potential builds. I mean, I can't put a really number on it, but it feels like they're cutting out like half of the builds you could possibly do just by this small little change.
Well, actually, but doesn't that make it easier change. To balance, though? From, I mean, playing devil's advocate, that might be part of the goal from ArenaNet, is specifically cutting down the number of possible builds to make it easier to balance things.
Well, I mean, I think another thing that we all need to really look at is the fact that this is still the beta, so maybe they're trying this specifically for the next beta weekend event to see if people can still make those builds that are outrageous, like that one, like the glass cannon warrior builds that two-shot you, or something like that. I feel like that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to limit the potential for builds like that. But the thing is, you know, yeah, it's harder to balance when you have it the way they did have it, but, you know, you're making everyone happy when you do something like that because there's so much customization, and that's what people want. They don't want to, well, if I'm going to make an engineer, I need to put 10 points into this just to get that one skill. Otherwise, I can't make a build. Now they're driving you into a cookie cutter as opposed to letting you just do what you want.
And I should point out, I don't think this is like an, oh my god, the sky is falling, Guild Wars 2 is doomed sort of situation here. I think as Lena Lionheart in the chat there pointed out, there's still like 20-something utility skills that you can choose from, and there's still all the different minor traits and how you're going to choose from those trait lines. So there's still a lot of customization in there, and there's still the sigils, and there's still the, what's the other, besides the sigils, the, not insignias, jewels, sigils, and runes. There's still quite a bit of customization in there. This just feels like one of the things that I really loved about this system is how different it was from the 31-point talent tree thing in World of Warcraft or the 21-point in League of Legends. I don't know. Freelancer, do you have an opinion on this one?
Oh.
We can't hear
your
you.
Mic.
Your mic's
muted.
Muted.
Okay,
there
sorry about that. No, not too much. I mean, what I'm wondering is, okay, these patch notes, is this going to be next beta weekend event? Do we know this?
We don't know.
You know.
It seems like possible, but we also know that the first beta weekend was probably a month or two old in terms of the code because they have to go through a lot of, you know, testing beforehand. So it seems unlikely that everything in the patch notes will be in the next beta weekend.
Yeah, because it's one of those things that I really hate to say that it's for the better or worse without actually testing it.
That's true.
I gotta say though, if it's in the next next patch notes, it's gonna be very interesting the way structured PvP has changed.
Mm-hmm. I think the smart idea is to reserve final judgment until we actually get to the point of playing it. And for all I know, maybe they're changing some of the weaker traits and trying to make them more appealing to that sense too. But if this change means they're trying to make, instead of all of the traits being, you know, balanced against each other, just making three tiers of traits and saying it's okay to have weak traits, medium traits, and good traits because you're going to have to take one of each in every line. I don't know. Maybe that'll work. I'll have to play it.
Well, I mean, the thing is, like, good, bad, or indifferent, whatever this new system is, it's still a fact that it's now more limiting than the previous system.
And like I said, you can
whether
say
it's good, whether it's good or bad, right. But I mean, fact is, you're limiting people's options. So.
Yes, and we saw how good, like, huge unlimited possible builds worked out in Guild Wars 1 in terms of in terms of trying to balance that monster, right? I mean, it just seems like that's like a little bit too off the deep end of, you could do anything. You could have any of these classes combined with any other classes, and each of them has hundreds of skills, and you could choose any 8 of them from these hundreds and hundreds and exponentially massive possible numbers. And, you know, so this might be a sort of reaction to, like, well, we may have gone a little overboard in Guild Wars 2 as well. Let's back it off a little bit.
As long as they don't break my stun build, then I am perfectly good. Giga, how about that 9-second stun there?
Oh, is that the Mesmer one?
Yeah, that's my my troll build, but it actually ended up being
really, I hear that's why they're doing
this. Super effective. Yeah, they're doing it just because Freelancer found a troll build.
Yeah,
diminishing return. Oh. So,
but it shut down players. It didn't do a lot of damage, but I remember going up against Giga. He was a Mesmer as well. He had his own awesome build, and we would just go at it, and I'd just stun lock him for like 6 to 7 seconds where he couldn't do anything. And he would just run away and come back, and it was back and forth. It was great. They really need to nerf it, though. I'd be the first one to admit that stuns need to be nerfed incredibly.
Yeah, definitely. I think diminishing returns are a must. And I actually think that, like, the durations of the stuns or things could go up a little bit if they had steep diminishing returns afterwards. But anyway, regardless of that, we'll talk about that at another point. Let's jump back into a few more of these patch changes here. PvP gets a whole bunch of improvements, and later on they talk more about automated tournaments and things, so that stuff seems to be going into the game. Whether it's going to be in the next beta weekend, we don't know. You know, this is something that we knew was being added, but here's a little confirmation. World versus World, they talked about fixing the fact that some of the things in World versus World wouldn't show up red circles, like the siege weapons and things like that, but they talk about how gadgets can now insert their shard names into their name if they know their World versus World team, which was annoying to me because I would see, like, leftover rams or something at the gates of a castle, and I had no idea if, like, they're our rams or the enemy rams until I tried to, like, attack them. Was there any trick that you guys found to know which, if there was just an abandoned siege weapon, if it was yours or enemy?
I mean, for myself, it was, I had to keep a diligent eye to make sure every siege weapon was manned. But what you usually found, Bridger, and I think you noticed as well, is everybody crowds on the siege weapon, so it's never empty.
Well, I mean, you know, so we go and we take a keep, right? And then we go and move on to the next one, or, you know, Zerg moves on to the next one. There were siege weapons maybe that were set up outside that thing that are now just left because the keep's already taken. So it's hard to, you know, they're just orange. They're not any kind of text. So anyway, this seems to be like, yeah, now you can see, oh, that says green, you know, catapult. So maybe in the few situations like I'm talking about, that'll be useful. But I agree with you. Most of the time, it's probably not necessary because it's your teams are already hanging around them. Squad members may now speak into the squad channel. This is a pretty big change if they actually go through with it because they talked about, when they made the squad system, like, yes, this is going to be top-down only, and the commander can only talk to them, and they can't talk back. So apparently they relented a little bit on this, maybe. Any thoughts?
Yeah, that's what everybody was wanting. I don't think it's going to be a big change. I mean, it's just allowing you to talk directly to your commander, I guess, is the idea of it, so.
Yep, and there was a lot of good reasons people gave, like, okay, so I'm in a squad of, let's say, 200, you know, or let's say I'm joined the squad of 80 people. I'm falling around world versus world. Let's say this is just me. There's no other Team Legacy guys on, so I just jump in and find a squad. And, like, this is the idea behind the squad system, right? You're supposed to be able to go in and just join up with random people and have fun following them around in world versus world. So the squad leader is sending commands like, all right, we're heading to this castle next, and, you know, hey, guys, you know, go get resupplied over here and whatever. He's doing a great job being a commander. I'm looking around behind us, and I can see there's a Zerg coming up behind us. Well, if I type in slash team, that's the entire world versus world team across all four maps, as far as I know. So how does the commander know if I say, commander, check out behind us, there's bad guys. Like, every commander on every map is going, where are they? I don't know. Like, I could maybe find his name, but this is just a random guy that I found. I don't even know what his name is. Maybe I forgot it. Maybe I don't know how to spell it, how to type it, how to say it, whatever. So and then if I do slash say, maybe he's just out of slash say, and that doesn't work either. So having squad chat be for just the members of that squad allows you to give that information to everybody and not even just the commander. And everybody would know exactly who you're talking about. So if you're trying to tell the entire squad, stay together so I can cast swiftness on everybody, then you can tell that to the squad without having to use slash say and hope that everybody's in range. I don't know. So we'll see how this works out. Now, this is a change. Which guy, Akku, do you play a ranger? Or did you change to necromancer, didn't you?
Yes, I changed to necromancer.
Anybody here play ranger?
Nope.
Well, the ranger pets, it says, quote, pets can no longer be swapped out to instantly come back to life. Now, I think what this refers to is if I've got a bear and a wolf, and my wolf is out and my wolf dies, I can swap to a bear and the wolf automatically comes back to life in my inventory. And then I think there's a cooldown on the swap, but when the cooldown's over, I can swap back to the wolf and the wolf have come back to life, basically. I guess that's what it means. I don't know. Maybe it means that when you're out of combat, you can swap them out and to a new one. It's hard to read that. And there was a lot of speculation. Nobody seemed really sure on what this meant. So it's hard to say exactly what the circumstances are going to be around that. But keep in mind, something weird's going on with ranger pets.
They're dead and they're walking around.
Optimization. They put some optimization stuff here. World versus world. Commander markers should no longer cause severe server lag. Like the little arrow above a commander's head. Blame freelancer.
I was the only one in our server that had it, so that just completely put me at fault.
Yeah, apparently.
I'm never going to get messages about that now.
Look at this huge amount of UI things. Nothing in here I found was particularly super interesting, but you can read through this if you want. Again, the show notes are on talesoftyria.com. Tales of Tyria, not Tales of Tyria. Like, Tales a Tyria. Come join us. Okay. So, again, chat, they said team chatting is prevented in all non-world versus world and non-PvP maps, which is good, because I had a couple of instances where I was in Queensdale and I was seeing team chat from the world versus world. I was like, well, that's not right. I'm not supposed to see that, I don't think. And non-PvP maps, so that's good. Team chat is now game server based. I'm not exactly sure what that means. It may be that they're making the map-wide chat not talk to the other team. We'll have to prepare for that maybe being the case. And then those things that I was talking about before. PvP added tournament UI. There we go. We're talking about that. Items. Transmuted items are no longer colored purple. They now take on the rarity color of their attribute item. So the stats of the item that you transmute keep the same color when you transmute the item together with its new skin, which is kind of nice because it will let you know, because otherwise transmuted items could have been anything. It could have been, you know, a junk blue that you got when you were leveling up, or it could have been this awesome legendary item that you got somehow. And it says legendary items are now purple. So they're not epic, they're legendary, I guess. And that means legendary items used to be red, so now there's a new step between legendary, and I don't remember what the other one was, but the one down from legendary, which is orange, I think it's like artifact or epic or something like that, super rare, whatever. There's now a new step in there, so we might have a new step of rarity that takes over the red slot. Who knows? We'll see. And this is the big one at the very end. Skill point challenges added to world versus world. How are they going to do that? Are you going to, like, train with the garrisons of the keeps that you hold? What's going on? Any thoughts?
I think it'd be like you sit at PvE, you know, where you run up and you talk to them or you buy something and you just get it right off the bat. And I don't think it's going to be anything super serious.
Gotcha. Giga, you went dark on us. What happened? Don't turn into an alien. That freaked me out last time.
But it's nice that they're adding the skill points like that worldly world, because I think a lot of us that were doing worldly world, like just worldly world during the fellow beta, were having issues with skill points towards the end, because some of those skills, when you buy them, you got to spend like 8 points or more.
Yeah,
to get some of the best ones. And we had guys that were hitting level 30 that, you know, both in the stress test and the last fellow beta, that just, they had been doing so much worldly world, they were so far behind in skill points, whereas the guys coming from PBE had just too much skill points. Like, they're like, what do you want? I'll buy whatever skill you need. You know, it was no big deal. So I'm glad.
Yep. All right, so that was the patch notes, and there were a couple other things that people pointed out. It seems to be a new UI for the gem store. It seemed like they had a new UI and look to that. So we'll see how that looks in the new the next beta weekend, if those indeed are what comes of it. But for now, 40 minutes into the stupid show, let's actually get to our main topic here. I think it's going to be another one. Winter is coming, but we will not adhere to it, unfortunately, tonight, I don't think. Let's talk, though. I've been signed out for some reason, even though I need to edit this document. Too many people. I got to sign in. I don't know how I signed out. There we go. Let's talk about hardware here, ladies and gentlemen. First, I want to tell you guys about the resources that you can have at the Team Legacy website. That's teamlegacy.net. There is a PC advice forum in which you can find, you know, help from all of the hardware gurus that frequent the Team Legacy forum. So if you're saying, I need to get an upgrade, here's my system, what is the, you know, the best thing that I, you know, cost-effective thing that I could upgrade right now? Do I need more RAM? Do I need a new hard drive? Whatever. So that's a good place to do that. There's also a forum that has the current top picks for processors, gaming mice, gaming headsets, gaming keyboards, graphics cards, and sound cards. So there's a lot of good discussion going on in there about the various, you know, best of, you know, this is what I like, this is what I like, different recommendations. So that is a really cool place to hang out.
Let me throw something in too. A lot of people may be asking, you know, what makes this PC advice forum different than others? And that's a perfectly valid question. The reason Team Legacy, the forum, is what it is because we don't take BS answers, you know, the opinionated answers and the, well, I, you know, if somebody asks you, is a Sandy Bridge, is this going to work and run Guild Wars 2? You know, the right answer would be somebody that actually knows what they're talking about, and they explain yes and why, and they back it up with research. That's what that forum is filled with. What I can't stand, Bridger, I think you see it as well, is other websites, they just, it's just all, you know, oh yeah, I think it'll work fine, dot, that's it. Yeah, that doesn't help you, you know. So then you got people that like, is this NVIDIA card going to be better than this ATI card? And you post it on one forum, and they'll be like, "Well, ATI sucks." That's it.
That's your answer, right there.
And that's their answer. And it's like, you know, and it's, that's why I really encourage, if you guys are curious about PC hardware, you want people to give you a thorough response. Yeah, like Bridger said, I definitely recommend you go there, because we moderate it pretty hardcore in terms of the answers. They have to be on par and with knowledge.
Or I recommend these branded such and such. The branded such and such comes with so many great features. Let me tell you all about them. Yeah, that doesn't sound like marketing at all. All right, so let's talk peripherals. Now, the big thing, Aku, I gotta cut over to Aku. He just had a supernova explode, like his computer's camera, and keeps trying to account for the fact that it's dark in the room, and it just made your light look like a supernova now. Okay, so let's talk keyboard versus like a gaming keypad that basically takes over the WASD function. So for those of you that are not familiar with it, I'm going to open up a couple of links here and show you what a gaming keypad looks like. The most common one that people are familiar with is probably the Nostromo from Razer. So let's do this here. There we go. So there you can see the Razer Nostromo. You basically, it would replace your left hand where it would normally be resting on the WASD spacebar. It would sort of hover on this thing here. So let me see if there's a couple more pictures of it. You can see like there. Another one that is fairly popular is the Logitech G13. I don't know if it's popular, but it's another popular competitor, I guess. And it does the same kind of thing. It's got a little joystick there. The Nostromo also has a four-way D-pad. It might be eight-way D-pad there for the thumb. And then this one here, which Gigawatt was going to tell us about, the Wolf Claw. I guess or the Warrior is what it was called here. So this is very interesting because it's actually got the keys on there too and not just anything else. You can actually hit the number keys on this one. That's kind of cool. And then the space bar is just this vertical line. That's really interesting. So who here uses the Nostromo?
I do.
Aku, tell us about it.
It has 14 buttons, as you can see right on the where your fingers would be, your first four fingers. And the little D-pad is where your thumb would be. And I've been using it for going on 7 years. Actually, Razer recently bought it off of Belkin, mm-hmm. And I find that my gaming has increased just because of it. I don't know, that's kind of a very weak phrase to say, but I have very small hands, so reaching like, you know, number 8 on my keyboard is actually pretty difficult for me. So having having all my buttons right where I need them to be helps immensely.
I don't think anyone could reach the 8 key unless you're like Andre the Giant or something.
Who would need to reach the 8 key? Bind it to F or G.
That's what I usually do. But this does put, you know, a lot of buttons in your fingertips. It's also got a scroll wheel, so you can have dueling scroll wheels. Your right and left hand scrolling in different directions. Which one will win out? So
I think it's like impossible to hit.
The scroll wheel?
Yeah.
It looks like it would be right where the F would be, kind of. No, it's actually down where the V is, isn't it?
It's so low, like you can't reach it with your rightmost finger, and you can't get at it with your thumb because it's on the other side of that lip there.
So I got a question about this thing, because I had one back before Razer bought it, and it was still the Belkin, and I actually returned mine because I hated it so much. I want to know.
Ding 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 ding.
I want to know
Vega
what,
versus Aku, round one.
I want to know like specifically what benefit you get from it besides like
D-pad.
To me,
D-pad.
I mean, like, what do you use the D-pad for? Because I couldn't really find anything useful.
I actually, for the D-pad specifically, I kind of turned my attention more to console gaming. When you're holding a controller, most of your movement is done by your left thumb. So I said, why don't I just put WASD on the D-pad? I moved WASD to the D-pad, and literally I'm controlling my character, be that in World of Warcraft or whatever, through my thumb.
But how do you move like left and right at the same time?
I'm also on my mouse. I'm also holding the right button down like 100% of the time too. So it's, I don't know. Maybe it's a weird way of doing things, but I don't know. It works for me at least. Another cool thing that I've also done is that silver button right above the D-pad, mm-hmm. I bound that to Alt, and then the like that flat button right under the D-pad, I bound that to Shift. So all of those keys are also Shift and Alt modified as well.
Ah. So wait, the thumb button underneath the D-pad is not your jump? It's not your space bar?
No, actually, I have my jump on my other thumb on my Naga.
Gotcha. All right, so that's interesting. So why didn't you wind up liking it there?
I didn't find any benefit from it. Like, you know, if I put my hand on my keyboard, I still have access to the same amount of keys as I do in the Nostromo. The only thing I gain is the thumb little joystick thing and that button. You know, I could still reach, I could probably reach more keys on my keyboard with just my hand than I can on the Nostromo. So that's why, because I didn't really find it that useful, because then if I wanted to type something out, I'm like jumping back and forth between my Nostromo mm-hmm. and my keyboard, and I don't know. I just didn't see that great of an added benefit because, you know, if you look at it, what did you say there was 14 keys there?
Yeah.
So, you know, so it's not like something like that funky looking wolf lion UFO thing because that looks like it has a freaking 100 keys that I could reach with my hand. You know, I just don't see the added benefit besides that thumb device. But that's just me. I'm an old school kind of keyboard person. Minus my Naga.
I'm trying to
but
find
I did get
thing.
But I did get the Naga Hex, not the Naga Epic or whatever. The Naga that's got 30 buttons to my thumb.
FPS version.
So, but that's just me. It's really to each their own. I mean, if you like it, you like it. Whatever makes you play better.
Oh yeah, I agree. I mean, when I first got it, you know, I absolutely hated it, but it has a pretty decent learning curve, just basically turning everything on your keyboard to your left hand. So, I mean, for a while I was just like, oh, I don't want to use this, but I just kept forcing myself, and eventually it just became second nature. So, once again, as you said, it is kind of a personal preference, but I would say if anybody is interested in wanting to, you know, I don't know, try to use one of those, I would say the Naga, or excuse me, the Nostromo or the Warrior Pad, as Giga is going to tell us about, is, you know, a good benefit.
All right, so why don't you talk to us about that, Giga? You're using the Warrior?
I did use it for a while. They quit making it, and I didn't want to pay, you know, like $80 for a used one.
Gotcha.
So that just seems silly. So I ended up with a Nostromo. I've been using Nostromo for about 6 months. But truth be told, I actually preferred the Wolfclaw or the Warrior. They changed the name of it over the years, but because it gives you so many more keys, and because the way the function keys and the number row are laid out in a semicircle, like, they're all equidistant from your hand, pretty much. So you can press them all, like, all the way down to zero with no problem.
I feel like I can, like, dial a Stargate with that.
Yeah, right? Yeah. It's a really cool look to it, you gotta admit.
That's what I'm seeing when I see that controller. It's like, I just can't get Stargate out of my head.
I don't understand why there's a random K in the top left. It's such a weird button to put there.
The reason you have K and O and B and some strange keys like that, like H, N, and M, is because those are common binds in FPSs of the day. Like
K was kill, right?
And Battlefield. No, K was actually your chat. So you can press that and then quickly.
It's always been T and Y. Get out of here with K.
No, in Battlefield, it's like JK and L.
You got I all hated that. Players. I always rebound that to T and Y. TYU, that's always all chat, team chat, squad chat. That's how it always is and always will be. And if I can't rebind it, I'm not buying your game.
You tell them how it is.
So apparently, is anybody in the chat use this G13 thing? Because it doesn't look quite as good.
It's an older version of the Nostromo, that's all.
Yeah.
It's been around a long time.
It's got an LCD screen, Freelancer. Clearly you can display important information.
It does now. That's the advanced. It never used to.
Yeah.
But that's been around since WoW first came out. I believe it was originally made for MMOs. And it's just like the Nostromo. It's, for some people, it's better because it's not as complicated and there's less things to break on it.
Fair enough. Okay, so now I just want to point out to you guys, clearly the superior of all of them, the Microsoft Sidewinder Strategic Commander. This here.
What?
This is it right here. This is for when you're playing RTS games. The idea being that the whole top half of this is on a slider. It can go in four directions. So if you wanted to move the screen, like in Warcraft 3 or Starcraft, you could, you know, push the whole thing forward and it would move the screen around where you would go. And then you have the three shift buttons on the bottom and then you have all these buttons on the top for your other fingers.
I feel like that thing's going to shoot out tentacles and attach to my brain or something.
It does. It was a disaster. I can't use my whole arm to move the screen around. It felt really awkward to not use like your wrist. Like on the mouse, most of the moves you do with your mouse, I do with my wrist. I don't move my arm across the whole desk and scrape my skin back and forth. You know, it just seems really weird. I did have this at one point, though, and I regretted it because I tried to use it and I just couldn't get around to it. But this is how big it was in comparison, as you can see there.
Oh, so, my goodness.
Clearly the supreme keyboard attachment.
It's monstrous.
Yeah, it is. So that's that. Let's talk about keyboards, though. Because, look at that. We got animated GIFs going on here and everything. Keyboards, man. This is This is where it's at. You may decide, you know what, these Nostromo things, I don't think I need it. I got everything going with my keyboard here. But if your keyboard is not a mechanical keyboard, you are missing the heaven that is a mechanical keyboard. I am telling you right now. And that's where we get to this guy here. These links are in the what you call it here, the show notes, as it were, on talesofterria.com. And what you're seeing here are the different kinds of popular mechanical keyboards, and they're known as Cherry MX switches. And those are the things underneath the key itself that do the actual activation. And the ones that you're really going to be concerned with are the blue down here. Now, that's a sort of classic clicking keyboard. When you think of like those mechanical keyboards, like the IBM Model M, this one seeks to replicate the feel of those old buckling spring keyboards. And the brown up here tries to hold on to the same feel as those clicky keyboards, but without quite as much noise. So if you are living with someone or your keyboard's in the bedroom with somebody that you might sleep with, and you don't want to make so much noise, like my situation is, I got the Cherry MX Browns, and I'm very happy with them. Not shown on here is the Cherry MX Blacks, which many gamers prefer because of what we call a pressure chart here. I'll show you right now. Here we are. Force diagrams. So why should you get a mechanical keyboard? This chart right here shows you why. This is a typical rubber dome keyboard. And if you don't know what a rubber dome keyboard is, you're probably using one. This is basically all the $10 to $15 keyboards that you've ever seen anywhere in the office. And if you buy it, this is it. This is your standard keyboard. It's got a little rubber dome underneath the key itself. And when you depress the key, you're actually sort of forcing this, you know, Rubbermaid style rubber to sort of compress, and then when it gets to a certain point, it kind of buckles. And at the middle of the dome, when it hits the bottom, when it bottoms out, it actually contacts a metal piece there, and that actually triggers the switch. Now, why is that bad? What's wrong with that? Well, let's take a look at this force diagram here. And for those of you that are listening, I'll try to do my best to describe this. The force diagram shows that when you first start applying force, the force that's pushing back on your finger grows and grows and grows, and then after you get past the first step where the dome sort of contracts in on itself, then it very quickly, the pressure releases as you get past that contraction moment, and then you still have to press further until the key hits the very bottom of the keyboard before you have contact. And that's the problem, because ideally, once you feel the key give and sort of contract all of a sudden, get past that point of ultimate pressure, that's when you should have the key activate, because that's when your fingers can detect, oh, I just felt a change. And that's why typing on a mechanical keyboard is so fast and easy, because you can take your finger off of a key knowing for a fact that it registered. Whereas on one of those dome keyboards, you won't quite know because you have to push it all the way to the bottom. So let's take this diagram and compare it to what a mechanical type keyboard looks like. What you see here is instead of at the very end of the key compression, it's in the middle of the key compression, right after the key suddenly buckles and contracts. You know, it builds pressure, and then it's easier for a split second. And after it gets easier, you know that you have actually contracted the key and actually registered it in the computer itself. So I don't know. I just turned into a giant keyboard nerd there, but I hope that explains it to everybody. This is a chat room. Is that make sense to any of you in there, or am I just talking like complete nonsense?
It does. A few things should be noted, though. Number one is mechanical keyboards are very loud. You know, yes. They do have the brown ones, and people should acknowledge that, because if
even
you're
the brown
a streamer
one is loud.
Or
like
if you're
I'm typing,
a,
you can still hear that.
Yeah, and if you're doing something that you're in an environment that you might annoy somebody, let's say you're married, your girlfriend, whatever, your computer's in your room with somebody else, or it could be any number of scenarios. You got to keep that in mind, because I've heard many a story of guild members buying a mechanical keyboard and then they have to return it, not because they didn't like it, it felt awesome, but because they just made so much noise that in the middle of the night with their dorm mates, they were just waiting, you know, it was just keeping everybody up.
Mm-hmm.
Now, aside from noise, if you're by yourself, you got a good headset, we got your Sennheiser here, and you could drown that noise out, then it's awesome. There's nothing that beats a mechanical keyboard. And there's a lot of great brands out there. What brand did you end up getting, Bridger?
I wound up getting a Rosewill, which I think is Newegg's brand.
It is, yep.
One of the things I really like about this one is, and I don't know, maybe I can show it to the camera here. Let's see. You might be able to see is inside. It's very difficult to see, actually. Let me do this. Turn the light. I don't know if you can see that, but there's like this red metal plate that runs through the length of the entire thing, and it gives it a really solid feel. And since I'm transporting it to work, because I hate to type on my work keyboard after getting this, it feels a lot better to me to have that solid metal plate. And it also gives it a sort of cool look. If you look down into the keys, you can see this red plate sort of staring back at you, like I've just deposited the last piece of blood from my last gaming thing down into the bottom of the keyboard. So I like the Rose Wheel. It was a pretty decent price, like $110. It's another thing to think about when you're getting these mechanical keyboards. You almost will never find one cheaper than $50. But the good ones will be somewhere between $90 and $110 from my experience. So very quickly, I did talk about the blues and the browns, which are some of the more common ones. The blues are more clicky, but they do have more of a tactile feel. It makes it feel a little bit better to type on. But the browns are a little bit less loud, but they are semi-loud. We've got to acknowledge that. And the blacks are the ones that people talk about as being really good for gaming because they don't actually have a pressure differential. It's a static pressure all the way down, and you can sort of ride. So if you had to hit the same button over and over again, like in a fighting game or something like that, and you had to go, that really works. What is that noise? We got a popcorn going off in the background there? What's going on? There it goes. Okay. Somebody is replicating the slamming of the keys. So blacks are another one that people say is good for gaming, but not as good for typing because there's more, like 75 grams of pressure is required to push the keys down, whereas the browns, I think, are 45, and the blues are somewhere around 45, 55. But for more information on this, if you want to figure out what brand to get or learn more, like, everything I learned and I talked about is on this page here, which is like the guide to mechanical keyboards on this geekhack.org website. Definitely go and check out the links in our show notes. It's got a link to this as well as a guide, a shopping guide that talks about, basically breaks down all the different ones. Like it has tactile and non-clicky, tactile and clicky. So it talks about, you know, Cherry MX Browns, Cherry MX Clear, Cherry MX Blue, Cherry MX Reds and Blacks and Whites and stuff I'd never even heard of before. So, you know, you can click on the brown here and see 45, and you can scroll down and I think my Rose Wheel right here. There you go. Boom. Done. So there, this one has prices, and it shows you all the different variations you can get. So this is a great resource if you're looking for a mechanical keyboard. So I think that about wraps up the keyboard section, but yeah.
I wanted to throw one last note in for all of you guys out there that are doing structured PvP that have your ambition to go to tournaments, etc. I've been there. I know what it's like, and I can tell you one thing. If you're looking at like a G110, or if you're looking at an Estramo, or you're looking at a Razer Naga even, forget it. Anything with a memory chip in it, for the most part, turn around, go back out, get yourself a new keyboard. Anything with macros on it, forget it. Turn around, go get yourself a new keyboard. If you get to that scene where you're going to be going to an actual site, let's say PAX, MLG, what have you, and you are bringing something that, you know, even though it's flashy, right there is G110, Bridger has up now, and, you know, it's great, and you love it at home. Be very, very careful about it, because if you get too used to it, like the Destramo, you know, with if you're going to get attached to it, and then when you actually go and you have to play on a normal keyboard, such as a mechanical keyboard, which they will accept, you're going to be, you know, given the door, and then you have to play with something you're not used to, and then you're not at your optimal level. So that's another big, big plus for mechanical keyboards. They are the best of the best. They don't have all the fancy macros. You can get them with macros.
There are some that do have come with macros, but I think that's a very good point. If you do want to bring something to a tournament and you want to use what you're used to, get a straight up, like the Rose Wheel that I got is just a mechanical keyboard. There's no fancy smancy software that comes with it. There's no chip in it, exactly like Freelancer's saying. So there's plenty of those out there, but if you just want a really cool one to use at home, there's plenty that you can get from Logitech or any of these other ones that are mechanical keyboards that have these mechanical switches, but also come with the fancy schmancy LCD screens or the changing colors like the G110.
And there's nothing wrong with those. It's just there. I know there's people listening that want to, you know, they see themselves doing that. They see themselves eventually going to a LAN tournament or something. And even a local GameStop LAN tournament, they will immediately check your hardware. And if it has anything to do with any of what I just mentioned, you'll have to either they'll loan you one or you'll have to go get yourself a regular one. You have to go run to the nearest Walmart. I've seen way too many kids and young adults have to lay down their keyboard that they just spent $100 for and then turn around and go run to the nearest Walmart so they can get back for the tournament in time.
All right. So I think that does it for keyboards. Let's talk mice, guys. And I'm going to start out with the mouse that I use because I love this sucker. The G700 from Logitech. And I've been using Logitech mice for a long time. Before I had this, I had the MX1000, which was their first laser mouse that I bought at CPL 2004, maybe 2005, I think. And man, that thing lasted me a long time. So this, what I like about this mouse is A, it's wireless, but if you plug in the charger slash USB cable, it becomes a wired mouse. It then uses the USB so you don't have any of the lag. So when you're just, you know, using the computer normally, just surfing the web, whatever, you can actually use it wirelessly and you don't have to worry about the cord getting caught or anything like that. But when you do plug it in, it becomes a wired mouse and you don't have to worry about any lag from wireless at all. So it's dual purpose there. It's also got four thumb buttons, which is something that I really like about it. And I always use my thumb buttons for so many things, for dodging, for crouching, for crouching in all of my like first person shooter games. I always use my thumb button to crouch, and you can use it to switch weapons. You can use it to activate special abilities, like in Tribes, the three the different special abilities that I have are Super MSN, Super MNC. I use it for special abilities. In Guild Wars, I actually use the thumb buttons for my first four weapons skills in the game. So, and then I use those three buttons that you see on the index finger. This is especially well suited to MMOs because usually in first-person shooters, you're using your index finger to fire, but in an MMO, you almost always are having your right mouse button held down all the time. Your left index finger, or sorry, your index finger isn't doing anything to the left mouse button most of the time. So these three buttons are perfectly suited to using for your utility skills, for example. So that's what I really like about those. And then on the top, it has another button here, which you could customize, but what I actually use it for is to switch between the different key setups. So we can look at it right here. If I press it once, it shows that I am in the 3. If I press it again, I'm in 1, 2, 3. So 3 is actually my setup for streaming. And that means all of these buttons will cut to different people. So if I click this one, we'll cut to Aku. There we go. If I click this one, I cut to Freelancer, etc. So I've bound all of these to do that. Now, if I suddenly, like, let me go back to myself here. If it'll work, there we go. What is this? What is this nonsense? This is the best mouse ever. You should get it when it breaks down in the middle of the stream. All right, so then if I switch over to my 2, now I'm in gaming mode, and all of these are bound to 67890 dash equals, and that just is the setup that I have found that works in the majority of games. So the fact that, and then of course, when I'm in normal mode, we'll do back forward in my browser, copy paste, or open a search window, various other things that you'll be using for productivity within your Windows environment. So I love the fact that with a click, I can change all the functions on the mouse. Now, for those of you that play first-person shooters and really love the sensitivity thing, this will also allow you to change sensitivities on the fly or with the different, what do they call them, profiles. You can change sensitivities as well. So those are all the reasons why I really love this G700. What do you guys use? Aku?
I use the Razer Naga.
Okay, a popular pick.
Love it. That equipped with my Nostromo, I literally don't even touch my keyboard. Like, with all the Alt and Shift modifiers, I have plenty of hotkeys for almost everything. And besides that, it's very comfortable. The wiring is like braided or something like that, so it's very very. It doesn't get caught up on anything. So I think it's a great mouse.
All right, let me pull it up here in the Razer store so that you guys can see what it looks like. There we go. So the thing about the Naga, for those of you that are not aware, is it's got 12 buttons on the side here. So yeah, if you want to put every button in Guild Wars 2 on your mouse, you almost can do it with this, basically. And it looks like it has a couple of different sides that can go on there for different feels for those of you that like different things. So this is like thumb button heaven here, I guess, if you could say that. Somebody in the chat was talking about Logitech shares. I don't know what that is. You're going to have to elaborate for me there. I don't know. But so the Naga, now there's a new one that came out called the Naga Hex. So the first one, they say the Naga was supposed to be an MMO gaming mouse because it can fit everything on all your freaking bars on there. But the Naga Hex is supposed to be for like a MOBA because, yeah, maybe you don't need 12 buttons, but all you need is 8. So we'll put this in a, but they call it a hex even though it's clearly an octagon. What the hell is that?
That's a good point there.
We're going to call it a hex with 8 buttons. Fail. All right. So does anybody use the hex or anything like that? Anybody else use a Naga?
I got my Naga. And you have the hex, Vega?
Yeah.
What do you think about
it? What made you go with the hex instead? Well, I'll go first. What did you? What, how do you think? What do you like?
Well, so I went from, I had a rat, which the reason why I got the rat was because I like how you can adjust it for your hand. Like if you got a big hand or something like that, I thought it was comfortable. But then I wanted more buttons for Guild Wars 2, so I decided to, I thought 12 buttons was too much, but I liked the idea of having the 6 buttons. And also, you know, between Dota and all that stuff, so I went with the Naga Hex. And the biggest adjustment I had to make was that going from something like a rat, that I can make it be a really big mouse and heavy mouse if I want it to, the Naga Hex is a much smaller, lighter mouse.
It does have 6 buttons. Wow, yeah. I can't count.
Quick correction. Yeah. Bridger said it had 8, but actually I think it has 6, right?
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
That's 6 buttons.
Yeah.
They weren't. So. It makes more sense that they got that right than that I got it right.
So I the reason why I got the rat, because at the time I was playing a lot of FPS games, and they have this really awesome, it decreases the DPI so that you can get for, it's like a sniping mode pretty much. So when you're sniping, you push that down and you could be more accurate, or at least in theory you can. But I liked it because it was very customizable. I think it's a cool design in terms of all the crap they really fit on there mechanically. But the Naga Hex I like because it's definitely smaller. It feels good. It just took some getting used to because it is smaller and it's lighter. But I like having the 6 buttons because I felt like for Guild Wars 2, you know, I guess you don't need as many buttons as you would for like WoW or another MMO. You still need the buttons. So the normal Naga definitely is more than enough. But if you're kind of overwhelmed by too many buttons, the Naga Hex is a nice middle ground, I guess you could say.
All right. So Giga, what do you use?
I think he's muted.
You might be muted. I can't hear you.
Yeah, I got it. Okay. Cool. Stuff going on in the background. I use a Gigabit 8600. It's the actual model is like an Avia. I have the page right here. Yeah, Avia M8600. And it's just a really nice, more basic mouse. It's got, you know, all your advanced features on the fly, adjustable DPI, different macro profiles, your 4 and 5 buttons, and then your scroll wheel with 4-way scroll wheel. So it's nice. I like it. It's very accurate. It's very useful.
Looks like a race car. It's got
yeah,
stripes.
It's pretty mean looking. It's also got the option to be wireless or wired, and it's came with 2 batteries and a charging station, which is also a docking station. So I can like have one battery charging, or I can set it on top of it to charge. It's got a lot of options for power. Okay. I like it.
I don't know.
Not a bad looking mouse.
If the number of buttons on your mouse is like the size of your car, I guess. Yes, we get it. So, all right, so that's it. So it looks like Freelancer, you use a Naga, you said, too? You and Aku both use Nagas?
I got a couple of mice, but yeah, for MMOs, I use my Naga. Actually, you know what I found out is in Guild Wars 2, I don't even use it. So what I'll probably do is when I'm doing FPS gaming, which is mainly what I've done in the past, I have my, everybody knows this one, my trusty copperhead here. You can't go without a couple copperheads in your bag. So I actually carry a couple with me, 2 different colors, just for the heck of it, because just in case one dies. I mean, that's my mouse. You know, I'm used to it. I've played for years and years and years since I started gaming. And I just, you know, I don't need a, sorry, Aku, but I don't know. Was it Aku or Vega? Who had the one with the sensitivity on it? Vega, right?
Yeah.
So I hate to break it to you, but I don't need a sensitivity switch to spin around and headshot you. So
I never found the appeal of the sensitivity changes. I don't think I could get used to the
it's gimmicky.
I never actually use it very often. I just thought it was kind of cool that they put it on there.
Yeah, I always found – I did try it. I was a sucker. I bought one that had a sensitivity switch on it, and I thought, oh, this would be great, you know, when I'm playing either Counter-Strike or Team Fortress 2 just came out at that time. And
is the idea, you know, when you're zoomed in, you use the sensitivity change? Is that the idea? Or?
And that way you can change your pixels on a much more accurate level, but it didn't do it for me. I found it to be a hassle to switch back and forth. And if you're sniping, if you're doing it right – you know, in Counter-Strike, you're never zoomed in for more than a half second anyway. So, I mean, I don't think I zoom in for more than a quarter second when I'm playing Counter-Strike. And that right there, I mean, the idea with these mice is that you can zoom in and camp. And that's just not me. So I didn't really find much appeal to it. So I'm back to Best Buy. And
I think Citruso in the chat found your actual motivation for carrying around an extra mouse. He's like, you just like to put one into a free USB slot on a PC at a LAN party and slowly move it around to freak somebody out when they're playing. Like, no, my mouse is over here. I don't know what you're talking about.
Sadly, I've gone through many, many copperheads. I don't know if
there's
it's just...
There's not enough buttons on that thing.
But you don't need more than just your main button, though. I mean, if you're playing a shooter,
to be able to duck.
Well, my control.
To shoot.
Now, another big thing that you didn't cover is what do you think about custom gaming pads, like the mouse pads? Have you ever used one of those, Bridger?
Well, I don't know how custom it is, but I'm something also, and it's held up ever since. It's Intel Extreme Pentium Extreme Edition for your extreme gaming experience. So I don't know. I just have had this because it's huge. So I never run out of space when I'm playing. So
they're like control to shoot, WTF. Apparently, yeah.
Listen, my shooter setup is really weird. I use a combination of Doom and Quake because those are the games that I played together, and nobody ever told me about WASD when I first got Quake. So in Doom, Control was your shoot, and you use the arrow keys to move around. So my left hand was always on Control. So the right Control key for me is fire in an FPS. Now that does two things as far as I'm concerned, is when you're trying to aim something very far away in an FPS, if I have to click with my finger, often it will make my mouse move a little bit and I'll miss the shot. But if I don't have to actually click anything on my mouse to actually fire, I don't miss the shot. So maybe that's just me and I'm not used to doing that clicking thing. But anyway, then I have right shift and question mark are my strafe left and right. Enter is jump. And then I have a whole series of keys around there. Usually the quote key is reload. The semicolon is grenade. The forward, that's a backslash, is melee. And then I've got delete up, left. Left is actually usually my push to talk. Alt is walk if I need it. And then I've got period and comma to do maybe grenade switching or any other special abilities that I've got in the game. Like I use period for skiing and tribes. And then I've got all these keys on my mouse that I can use for selecting specific weapons. Like in TF2, select melee weapon, select main weapon, secondary weapon, things like that.
I'll tell you right now, I'm trying to lay out my hand like that. And
it's just index
so
finger
awkward.
On control, the middle finger on shift. Then the ring finger on question mark and the last finger on period. And the beauty of that setup is my left hand isn't holding down movement keys because mouse 1 and mouse 2 are move forward and move backward. So
that means
my hand can move around and hit buttons without.
You are so weird.
Bridger,
listen, it works fine.
That is fail.
It's not a fail. I can play very well with it, thank
setup.
You very much.
That is, no. Everybody,
what makes it objectively
this
worse?
This is what you need to do. You're going to thank me later. ESDF, rebind your WASD to ESDF, and thank me later. There you go.
I use WASD when I'm in World of Warcraft and when I'm in Guild Wars 2. But when I was a shooter, that's what I always got used to, and that's what I've always been using. I can't see a reason why it's objectively better to use WASD. In fact, when I tried to go to WASD, I found trying to hit like the 1, 2, 3, 4 while simultaneously moving was really difficult because I had to usually hold down two keys to like move in, you know, strafing backwards into the left or something, and then trying to do the finger gymnastics of getting my fingers around to those 1, 2, 3, 4 keys or down to the Z, X, C, V keys was just mind-numbing. So now that I have movement primarily or partially controlled with the mouse, that means my left hand doesn't have to hit more than just the shift key. So I'm only ever holding down one key with my left hand. All the other fingers are free to hit other things like reload, grenade, switch weapon, push to talk, etc. So that I find to be beneficial. So I haven't had any problems with it, honestly.
If someone comes over to your house to try and play on your computer, do you have to explain to them?
I have to hit the or default say, button to the chat.
You're better
the
off just not playing.
Keybinds.
Like, if I ever go visit Aku and he's got his Nostromo like set up, I'm gonna be like, I'm going home, man. You know, it's true. I mean, that's just bad. And like, how much does it drive you guys insane when you're talking to somebody and they're like, "Well, I use my arrow keys."
What? Oh,
that's just because like I still come across that. If I catch any of my guild members using the arrow keys to move their character, I will flip out. I'm just. I'm nuts. That's just I had to teach my when I was teaching my wife how to play WoW back when she was like, I'd love to play with you and do all the couple thing together on the computer. And I thought, okay, this is cool, let's do it. She could not get WASD down. It took me months to get her to get used to that.
Oh wow.
And
because every time you looked away, she'd go back to the arrow keys and remove all the work that you had tried to get.
Well, for a lot of new players that have never played a game, you got to think about this. A lot of Guild Wars 2 players are going to be first-time MMOers. And, we all like to think we all come from WoW and stuff. But, Guild Wars 2 is attracting the casual audience to the extent of Farmville players. Okay, so they are going to be coming in, and they're not going to know how to use WASD and all that. They're probably using the arrow keys. And that's got to be fixed immediately.
That's why defaults matter. Defaults really matter. When you had that Service Pack 2 update for XP, and it made it so that the firewall by default was turned on, millions of people stopped getting worms and viruses in Windows because, they don't know any better than turn it on, but defaults really matter. So if you're trying to get new people into the game, trying to tell them to hit the 6 through 0 key, that's what I had that whole rant about 2 weeks ago. So I agree with you completely there. Those defaults matter a lot. So they shouldn't even have the arrow keys move you at all, like by default.
I met a guy in WoW that actually had his movement as his arrow keys. Then he had like a skills on the control, shift, and enter key. Then he had other skills on like the 1, 4, and 7 on his numpad, and that's just how he played.
With
that's
his right hand, he would use that, or his left hand?
No, his left hand would be all the way to the right side of his keyboard, using like the right or the left side of his numpad, and the the right or right side of his normal pad, and that's just how he did it. And it was just like it blew my mind, and he was actually pretty decent at it. But I mean, to each their own. But if you're a newer player, guys, don't get into that arrow key habit, or if you do, don't tell me.
You're telling me you never used arrow keys, though. Never.
I've never used arrow keys, ever.
I did, because I remember playing DOS and Windows like 3.1 games with the arrow keys and with control and stuff, with no mouse at all, right? And then, like, when I started playing FPS, like in the Counter-Strike and Battlefield 1942, I moved over to the numpad. I never really used the WASD at all. I was a numpad guy, where I have my keyboard like moved all the way over to the left, and it just gave me access to more of the key, like none of the extra keys, and they were all lined up nicely. And so I just moved on to the Warrior, which gave me like every key imaginable, and then ended up with an Nostromo.
You know, the first shooter I played that we set up the WASD for was here we go, Oregon Trail. Okay.
Oh no.
That game got me. I played it at school so often, and we set it up so WASD would control it, and you had to do it via DOS, right? So you had to rebind it, and it was incredible. That was how I learned, and ever since then I used WASD. Everybody should do the same. Everybody should go out
to Oregon
Trail. If you have not played Oregon Trail, shame on you.
I tried it. I tried replay. I mean, I played it back in the old day, but I tried to play it on the iPhone. I was not happy with the implementation. All right. Anyway, we're getting way off track. Let's try to get back in here. Let's talk very briefly about monitors. What kind of monitors? Is there like a gaming monitor that you're looking for? Mostly it's based on response time and resolution is what my understanding is. Right, Freelancer?
Say it one more time.
Monitors. What's the key features for a monitor that you're going to use for gaming? I assume resolution and response time are the two features we're looking for?
A couple years ago it would have been response time. Nowadays it's more based on resolution and what your graphics card can put out. If we were having this conversation 5 years ago, absolutely, it'd be response times. But
they're all pretty much low enough now? Any decent
nowadays, they're all two millisecond, 5 millisecond, and that's perfectly fine. There's no discernible difference there. So, whereas back then, it could go even higher than that if you got a cheap Dell or something. So now, nowadays, I mean, your big decision is whether you want to get a, 2 millisecond, 120 hertz monitor or get a 2 millisecond, 60 hertz monitor, mm-hmm. AKA, do you want to see that clarity? And there's a lot of argument back and forth. I'm not going to really go into it, but
60 is definitely good enough. It's not like objectively, like you must get a 120 if you're a gamer.
Absolutely. Yeah. Everything is 60 now. I mean, unless you live in England, then you're running
then
50.
You're 50.
Hertz,
so that's weird.
Yeah. But then you're just weird. No, I'm just kidding.
Stupid metric system. Wait a minute. No, they don't even use that. English ton.
But yeah, unless you're living in over in Europe, you're running a 60 hertz monitor even now, and unless you have a CRT, for God's sakes, go fix now.
I remember being so excited when I got my first Trinitron CRT. Like, ooh, it's a flat screen. It's not like a curved screen back in the day. So yeah. What do you guys think for, let's just say, what's your preference for format, 16 by 9 or 16 by 10? Aku?
16 by 9.
Freelancer?
For my main monitor, 16 by 9.
Giga?
I use 16 by 9.
Vega?
I don't know.
What's your native resolution?
I just said it to what it looks good, and I just go with it.
What's your native resolution for your monitor?
What is it?
If you like, this if you
is
go
a, this
into
is
your,
an older monitor. It
if
doesn't
you go,
go
into
up
your
19,
computer settings and like,
it's 1680 by 1050. So 16.
Okay, you're right there with me. Fucking 16 by 10. That's where it's at. You guys in your 16 by 9. Shame on you. I just, no, that's not enough vertical space for me. I can't take it. I'm reading documents and have to scroll 6 times to get to the bottom of the stupid document because I can't see anything. I know that 16 by 9 is becoming the new standard and everything, but I really like 16 by 10 more. I think it's a great compromise between 16 by 9 and 4 by 3. 16 by 9 may still be great for cinema, but...
Actually, I just checked. I have a 16:10.
Oh!
I was curious. I was like, am I 16:9? Because I'm 2560 by 1600.
Oh, Jesus.
So that would be 16:10. And then I have the three monitors. So, yeah. I'm pushing out some GPU power, that's for sure.
There you
sure.
go, yeah.
I have 2560 by 1600. Now, I was telling you, my main monitor is 120 megahertz monitor, and I do... You guys are going to read a lot of guides when you're looking for monitors if you're in that market, but I do see, like, if I move my mouse over to my left monitor, which that's 60 and that's 60, there is a very visible difference when I move the cursor over the middle monitor. But yeah, that's what I have right now.
Richard, you need that monitor that I just linked.
Hang on, what is this? What is this? What is this nonsense? What is... No! No, I don't want this ridiculous... What is that?
Triple monitor in one.
A triple monitor in one. I guess that's what it is. Yeah, NEC, I like them. They're good. They make good stuff. Anyway, I really, if you're going for a 16 by 10 monitor, the resolution that you're looking for is at least... what is it? 1980 by 1200 is what you'll be looking for there. If you're looking for 16 by 9, you'll want 1920 by 1080. 1920 by 1080 and 1920 by 1200 are the two that I'm thinking of here. So those are sort of the minimum resolution. Mine is a 1680 by 1050. I got mine quite a while ago, so it wasn't when the monitors were up at that point. That does about for monitors. What about speakers or, let's say, gaming headphones? What brands do you guys use? Aku, what do you got?
I'm actually using Turtle Beach. I just got some wireless headsets.
I heard good stuff about them.
They're all right. I'm still kind of testing them. As of right now, they're not really doing much in terms of being bad. So that's what I'm using right now.
Okay, Freelancer, what do you have? You said Sennheiser, right?
Yep, I have Sennheiser, and I've customized, took my Dremel and went into it with drilled a bunch of holes for extra bass. But Sennheiser all the way. It's hard to explain, but yeah, it's a Sennheiser, but it's modified, and that's so I can enjoy games and explosions.
Gotcha.
Fuller, and I would never go to anything but a Sennheiser.
Okay.
I'll go into that a little later.
Is your Aku Freelancer? Do you guys have surround sound headphones, or are those just standard stereo?
This is a, I guess no, it'd actually be a 2.1 if you want to be technical.
Okay.
But I'm powering it off of a Zonar, so it actually emulates the surround sound. But I have my own surround sound if I want that for music.
Right.
So.
Fair enough.
Well. I think most headphones, they aren't actually true surround sounds.
Yeah.
I mean, they do make them, but they're like $1,000 or something outrageous.
Most of the ones that claim surround sound are more like simulated surround sound.
Yeah. Like somebody just linked, for example, the 7.1 G35. Little key fact for you there, Joshy, that is not a real 7.1. That what Vega was just saying is very much the truth. That is still only two speakers. Yes, they bounce the sound waves in a special way that makes you think like you're in a surround sound scenario, but that's actually the software behind it doing that. It's not so much your, but it still sounds great. You're right, so.
Definitely, and actually the one that I have is the G930, which is the wireless version of the G35, because I was looking for a pair of wireless headphones, and I actually... I have a hard time recommending these because they work well for me, but they don't work for my wife for some reason. Her pair just has a problem sometimes with interference, and I'm not sure exactly what it is sometimes, but when she, you know, gets up to go in the other room, like, they'll cut out as soon as she gets there, whereas I can go into the other room. I can walk outside with the dog and still hear the conversation going on in TeamSpeak for a while. It seems to be weird. Maybe we just got a really weird defective one. I've seen some other people that have that problem, but it might be a minority. I can't say for sure. I mean, I recommend them as far as how well they're working for me, and the volume control on the side is really nice, and the buttons can help you change some of the like your microphone level or something like that, so that's kind of useful. And the G35 is the same exact thing, but it's wired instead of wireless, which makes it cheaper. So if you're going for either of these, though, definitely don't buy them off the Logitech site. You can get a lot better deals on Amazon, I believe. And So
it's very, very important to note, though, with the USB headsets is that you are paying for the little extra features on them. You're not paying for audio quality. You're not paying for, the microphone may be decent, but, you're only getting what that USB slot can output on it, and it's not much. It's not going through a sound controller. It's not going through an onboard mixer. So for all of you guys out there looking at headsets, or maybe just via this podcast, maybe you want to think about getting a nice headset. You got to ask yourself, do you want those extra features like what Bridger has, which are neat and they're awesome? Or do you want, sound quality? Are you audiophile like I am? You know, do you want something that like they use in recording studios? And if that's the case, all right, two things. Number one, you're not spending anything less than $200. And number two, it's going to be a regular 3.5 millimeter jack headphone.
Yep, I actually.
And you're
going
to have to get a sound card to power it. You cannot run off of onboard sound. I've proven so many people wrong, and people will debate it to the very end. Oh, motherboard sound nowadays is so great, and it compares to.
It says Dolby on the box,
sound.
Freelancer.
Yeah,
it says Dolby.
Exactly. and you know, it's just fine. It sounds great. And then, you know, I'm like, you know what? Come over here. So I got my roommate. He's got his onboard sound, and he's not a big music listener, so he doesn't, you know, really care. Plug up my Sennheiser headset to his motherboard, play the same song. We mix it up with a little bit of dubstep and then go to rock, just so you can hear the highs and lows. Then we hook it up to my computer. It is a completely different world. So I don't want to hear the argument motherboards are just as good as sound cards. But be wary of that. You know, if you're shopping, you know, keep in mind that a USB headset is far more convenient. You plug it in. Bridger, I believe you just plug yours in and it works, right?
What, my G700 or G930?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You just plug and play and it's good to go. And that's the great thing about USB headsets. You don't have to set them up for the most part.
And often they're good for gaming as far as usually because you're looking for the microphone attachment. I mean, I've got this pair of 1/8-inch headphones for when I'm on the show, because in order to mix everything down in the mixer, I have to do that. I've also got this here, this microphone, for my awesome sound. And then, because everybody on Ventrilo, I mean, these microphones that come on these gaming headsets are usually pretty good. I mean, anything that you get, if you get a headset that has a microphone for more than $25, it's probably going to be pretty decent quality, and it'll get you on Ventrilo, and nobody's usually going to complain about the quality. You can get some really crappy, low-quality microphones, though. Stay away from anything less than $25, unequivocally, as far as I'm concerned. If it has a microphone on it, less than $25, no good. It's going to sound crappy.
You can go out now and get a good Logitech USB headset that sounds perfectly fine on TeamSpeak. And you'll hear music, and I got to be honest, Bridger, as much as I ranted about that, most people will not be able to really tell the difference unless you have a sound card. Mm-hmm. You know, it's when you get the sound card and this kind of headset that you really notice a huge difference.
Go ahead, Vega.
I will just say that I started out on that there's like a $30 Logitech one that mm-hmm. I've had for like years, and now I just got this Corsair one.
Corsair, that's a good one to add to the list here. Do you recommend it?
Yeah, it's an HS1. They don't make it anymore. They have like a new version out, but it's the same thing. It just looks fancier. But I mean, they're great. I mean, the only thing I would say is if you plan on playing a game and talking to people, don't be one of those guys that has your surround sound system on and then you don't use push to talk on your microphone and everyone's hearing everything. Yeah, like
the worst thing to go
invest,
on.
Invest in just that $30 headphones so you can talk to people and that they're not going to hear all the crap that you're hearing. I can't tell you how many of my friends that I was playing with them were like, that, you know, we play StarCraft or something, and I'm like, just get a headset. It's like $30. And then they wouldn't get it. And then they're using like their laptop mic and their laptop speakers.
Omnidirectional desktop microphones are the bane of any TeamSpeak server.
Yeah. It's just, a $30 Logitech headset is perfectly fine for anyone who just wants a decent headset.
I'm using a TT Esports Shock 1. It's a 5.1 channel surround sound.
Wow, you just hit me with a load of words that I had no... What is TTE? What's the brand?
TT Esports. Let me give you a link here.
Like Tango Tango Echo?
No, like Thermaltake.
Thermaltake. Okay, mm-hmm. I recognize that. Okay, TT... Like TT and then space... Esports Shock. I thought you said TTE. I got you now. Okay. Interesting.
It's USB sort of has some of those fancy features like the glowing, as you can see here. Mm-hmm. Definitely gives me gamer cool points, right?
Absolutely. Gamer cool points are easily worth $100.
But, running it with BF3 and stuff, it sounds really good when you get the surround sound on and working. Actually, for some reason, until I went into the drivers and turned that on, BF3 sounded awful. Like, distorted and stuff, and I turned on the surround sound. Like, that was amazing. I have had some problems with it with just the connector. I don't actually think it's a headset. I think it's actually my computer or the USB port just getting stressed or something. I had to switch ports on it, but other than that, it's been fantastic. Awesome. And noise canceling mic and its little controls here on the. Also, I can mute it when I need to, adjust volume and everything.
A-Rob's asking about sound cards. What kind of sound card brand do you represent? Sound Blaster? I think Sound Blaster's all the rage, right?
That's only what I know.
That's one for free. I don't.
I heard Turtle Beach is a really good brand.
I wouldn't buy a Sound Blaster if my life depended on it.
No, you're like creative. I remember Sound Blaster creative. Lives, man. They used to stamp those things out and charge you like $15 for them. Those were great.
Especially another rant another day. But those Fatality ones are the most god awful things you could buy, and it's just that branding. You know, all the casuals or all the nubs, you know, they got their paycheck and they want to go to Best Buy and I'm going to get a sound card because I have, you know, what the heck. And they go and they see that Fatality sound card there and they buy it. And it's like, I just want to bang my head against the wall when I hear that they did that. Such a horrible sound card. And back when it came out, it was great. Nowadays, they're so much better. Asus makes some incredible sound cards right now that are leading the market. You go to Newegg, go to Amazon, try it right now, sort it by review and best selling, and you'll see right now who's leading, and it's not Sound Blaster.
Yeah, let's point out something real quick. If you want to do any kind of audio recording or anything like what we're doing here, first of all, don't get a USB sound card. Like, there are external sound cards that you can get that plug into your computer via USB. The problem with those is that often they're powered by the USB cable itself. And what that means is you have audio signals and power running down the same cable. And if they're not really well shielded against each other, you're going to get this audible hum in the background of pretty much everything that you do off of that card when you're trying to record. So you want an internal sound card if you can get one, like a PCI sound card. And that's what I'm actually using. I'm using an M audio card on mine to capture the final mix of everything that comes out of the show here. So that's something to think about for sure, is get one of those internal sound cards if you're looking for really high quality stuff, and stay off of the motherboard too. Like Freelancer said. All right, I think we're running out of time here. So let's jump to the internals of the computer. Very quickly, sort of CPU, GPU, RAM, etc. So rather than do the kind of thing where, you know, we're just going to tell you what components you should buy now, because that means this particular show is kind of useless a year from now, right? If somebody starts listening to the show and they hear this whole thing and it's telling them to buy an i5 2500K, and like a year from now they're on to like the Ulti Bridge or whatever the next crazy Intel thing is, it's going to be useless. So I'm going to tell you step by step, this is how you figure out what you should buy for the internal to your computer, right? First, open your browser, okay? Step two, open your email client, gmail.com. Then step three, type in Freelancer's email address. Step four,
oh,
profit. No, I'm kidding. What you really want to do is go to tomshardware.com. This has worked for me for forever. Every time I build a new computer, I go to tomshardware.com. There's plenty of other sites. This is just the one that I happen to use. And in this one, you click on articles. Let's say we want to figure out what the best graphics card is. You click on articles, graphics. And then you scroll down until you find best graphics cards for the money, May 2012, or whatever month it is, because they post one of these every single month. And they'll say, okay, and then you say, okay, what's my price range right now? Let's say I'm looking for one between 100 and 150. You click that, boom, easiest thing you've ever done. It tells you right here, it says, don't even bother getting anything in the $110 price range, because it makes way more sense to just spend an extra $10 and get this card, which is way better and will last you longer. What are these stupid ads popping up here? So it really breaks it down for you and says, in this price range, this is who it is. And here's the reason why. And you can see the full review of this card here. And here's the price range for this one. You can scroll through the whole thing. So this is how I do for both CPU and graphics cards. Tom's has never let me down in the past. But the other thing to keep in mind is, with regards to graphics cards, is this will simply tell you what chipset you should be buying within this price range. The Radeon HD 6790 is a chipset. There are tons of manufacturers that make that card, and not all manufacturers are equal. So for that, you might want to talk to somebody that, or find a brand that's really good that you know. I don't know that many ATI brands. I don't make that many, but I think Sapphire, do they make ATI?
They do.
I think they're a pretty good brand. I've heard good things about them in the past.
That's who I usually stick to.
But the NVIDIA brand that I've always stuck with and heard really good things about is EVGA. That's the one I always go with.
EVGA, they're decent. They're solid. The warranty is good on them. I mean, a lot of people, they look at the power, because the different brands, they market it with these fancy little terms, and it takes somebody that knows what those terms mean to say, this isn't really worth the extra $20. Mm-hmm. But like with today's graphics cards, okay, like you got Gigabyte is known for their thicker PCBs on there. What that is the actual platter that they put all the capacitors and chips on. So that's always a big deal for overclockers, because that could take more heat. If you have a hot PC, you want a Gigabyte. The 670s that just recently came out, Gigabyte's doing really well on that front because they have three fans. So you want to look at the fans. You want to make sure it has decent cooling. Don't pay so much attention to the clock percentages. You know, if people are watching this a year from now, this is my advice. Don't look at this one runs 30 megahertz faster, because chances are you can pop it in there. You can get a little, you can get a Riva tuner, which is a great program. You can overclock your GPU to match any other brand out there that you were thinking about buying. Get the one, first off, check reviews. Tom's Hardware is great. I've never been wrong with Tom's Hardware, just like Bridger said. No, Tom's Hardware did not pay us for this.
That's but just the one just, I've always used.
There's just a genuinely Anand good
tech.
Site.
Anand Tech is another good one I've heard.
Yep. You got a lot of them. BitTech, TechCrunch, all of them. But check the reviews, first off. Go to Newegg, go to Amazon, check reviews on it. get an idea for it. But secondly, you want to look at the warranty, because the big thing between me and you is, if this graphics card that I recommended to you dies a week from now, is it covered? Or a year from now, is it covered? And certain brands are a lot better than others on that. Gigabyte is really good for that. They have 3-5 year warranties and a lot of other stuff. PNY, which is kind of an unheard brand, a lot of people don't know about it. They have some of the best warranties out there on their graphics card. 5 year warranty is on the last one I bought. So that's huge. I mean, 4 years from now, if your graphics card just goes kaput, I mean, if you still have it, it's covered. You got a new one. And that's a big deal. So look at that stuff. Be smart about it when you're buying it, and that way you can't go wrong.
The other one that I can remember,
I'm looking at mine right now.
EVGA
has a step up
program. So that let's say you buy the latest and greatest, you know, NVIDIA card or what have you from EVGA. If within the next 90 days a new line of NVIDIA cards comes out, you can pay the difference and just trade your card in. They'll send you a brand new card. So that's kind of a safety factor of the, oh man, I just bought a card and now they just announced the new ones are coming out in 2 months. So that's kind of a nice feature that they have there too. But yeah, so what's the ones that we said here are pretty good for GPUs? Let's see, EVGA, you recommended Gigabyte, and I think
speaking of Tom's Hardware, if you look at the 670 review on there recently, Gigabyte blew everything else out the water because of the three fans on it. It's such a big thing. Sadly, some manufacturers try to skimp, and they take advantage of the fact you don't know any better, and they only have one fan on them. Avoid those at all costs, mm-hmm. because those are the ones that are going to be running 70 Celsius, and you're going to be contacting whoever your computer techie is and asking, why is my computer running so hot? Because those graphics cards, that's this aside from your CPU, if not, depending on what kind of graphics card you have, it is the largest source of heat in your computer. And you want to make sure, if anything, that the airflow directed in and out of your computer is focused on that graphics card.
Yep, definitely very important to get those graphics cards cool. So what about aftermarket coolers for graphics cards? I haven't heard very good ideas you're doing.
Unless you're water cooling, it's not a big deal. I mean, graphics cards are designed to run hot, so usually the fans in them are just fine as it is. Some people, they like to hook up reservoirs, and they actually make all your big water cooling companies make these little reservoirs that mount onto the graphics card. You have to take the plastic off, and you mount the cooler on, and then, you know, it's not hard to do. A lot of people are a little like, oh, I don't want to mess with water cooling, but it's not hard to do at all, and it's not that bad either. It does a good job.
Okay, so let's talk about CPUs then. GPU, the AMD and NVIDIA, is there any clear winner right now? Sounds like ATI has been doing, well, ATI / AMD are doing pretty well. For a while, though, I think NVIDIA was the way to go pretty much all the time.
As far as GPU?
As far as GPU, yes, sorry.
Yeah, well, that's going to get half the chat is going to agree and half the chat's going to disagree. if you ask me, we'll do a quick roundtable, but my vote is easily NVIDIA for everything. Their drivers are always top-notch. Mm-hmm. There are numerous times through history, as everybody knows, that ATI just completely fell through on a game launch, and it's not necessarily their fault, but it is. And then when it comes to the processor, I stay away from Intel with a 10-foot stick.
From Intel?
AMD. I apologize. AMD. And that's because of the overclocking properties, AMD. I overclock and tweak every little ounce of juice that I can get out of my processor. And I've always gotten far more success out of an Intel than I have AMD.
Okay. So let's talk. GPU right now. What do you need? What's a good card to get? Let's say a good budget card, and that's going to get you decent frames in Guild Wars 2, let's say, even in World versus World, and then a good card, graphics card, that's going to allow you to really, like, excel and get max everywhere you go. What are we looking at?
Well, if you just want to play World v. World, you want to play at decent rates, and you want to, let's say, stream maybe a little on the side. Anybody that watched my stream, you saw... this was back before I upgraded a week ago, that I was running two 460s, and 460s, they're running not even $100 right now, I think. You can get them for around $100, $110.
This is NVIDIA GTX 460s, right?
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. And even somebody with a solo 460, if you're not streaming, you don't have any intention to stream or do like any frapsing or anything like that, one 460 will nearly max out the game. There's no reason to spend more money than that. Because, you know, we're talking about the best and all this, but most people, believe it or not, I like to think everybody is super analytical about it, but most people just want it to run. They don't necessarily care about getting the nice pretty particle effects a mile away, you know, and that's fine. A 460 for those people for about $120 is perfectly fine. Anything less than that, I strongly recommend, just like I tell my guild mates, that if you're running a 200 series or even lower, God forbid, you're not going to enjoy the game like you should. You need to at least get a 460 card or higher.
So what about for somebody who wants to future-proof?
Future-proof, there just recently, and go ahead and Google search 670 review. The 670 launched at $399 and just came out a couple weeks ago, depending on where you got it, a week ago. And the 670 is unmatched. It is 5% less in terms of performance at stock speeds than the 680, which costs $200 more. And so you're looking at
$200 for 5%
increase. That's a big deal. I'm sorry, $100 more. My math screwed up.
Fair enough.
So you're looking at something that's about a 20% price decrease and only a 5% performance decrease. And
now that's what I call value.
And it's such a big deal because you can pop it in, get yourself a tuner or overclock it a little bit, and match the performance of a 680. That is huge. And this is the first time ever, Bridger, for those that are like really speed demons, that getting a dual card, two 670s, outperforms the dual PCP card, the 690, which is like the bleeding edge card right now, mm-hmm. and for cheap, for much cheaper. You save about $250. So if you're, just sum it up, if you want something that's bleeding edge, that is going to max out everything in Guild Wars 2, and then possibly even run Guild Wars 3 on mm-hmm. on medium settings. The 670 is definitely where you want to go. Stay away from the 680. Stay away from the 690. That's just silly if you buy that. And you will definitely be very, very happy with your game.
And I should put in, if you want a good value card, that sort of in between the 460 and the 670, the one that I just picked up was a GTX 560 Ti with 448 cores. That one's a little bit more expensive than the straight up 560, but the 560 Ti with 448 cores, and that's the full name, that one is actually sort of a broken down 570, and the 560 is really just a souped up 460. So if you want to get a 560 that's actually like a generation ahead, then you want to get the one that's 560 Ti with 448 cores. And that one's sort of in between those two in price ranges. You can probably get it for about $230, $240. I think I got it for about $230 with a rebate. Like it was $270 with a $30 rebate or something ridiculous on Amazon or Newegg. I can't remember where I got it. So that's my recommendation for sort of a midway card between those two. If you can't quite spend $300, that'll do you.
Yeah, the big reason why I skip over 500 series, people listening and also chat said it, is because with the 500 series, they still were running on, not going to really go into details, but they were still running on the 40 nanometer process on most of the cards. And even on, like Bridger was saying, some of them were still 55 nanometer, like basically 400 series refurbished cards that they just relabeled for a 500 series. So what you're getting out of 500 series, unless you buy a 570 or a 560, you're not really getting what you think you're getting. It still runs hot. It's still, you know, clock for clock, it's still about the same power as any other similar 400 series card. A 460, matter of fact, if you look at charts, is only about a 10 to 15% speed difference between a 560. Whereas a 560 to a 670, for example, or let's say a 570 to a 670, is still a 15% increase, but the temperatures have dropped over 30%. That's such a huge, huge deal. So while your 570 might be running at idle, let's say 55 Celsius, okay, that 670 will be running near 45 Celsius, and that's such a huge
waited.
No, I mean, it's, well, you got the EVGA step up, right?
Yeah, I think it
there you go.
might come in handy right about now. I don't know. We'll see. It might have been more than 90 days ago, I think.
But your big difference between 500 and the 600 series is temperature. It's such a huge difference. And temperature is everything. Temperature is what kills your PC. Slowly but surely, that's the thing killing everything inside your computer, whether it's your processor or otherwise. So you can be sure that whether you're overclocking or otherwise, the 600 series, being that it's on a much smaller process, is going to run a lot cooler. And the wattage draw, did you get this, Bridger? This 2670s in SLI, what kind of power supply do you think you need for that?
2670s in SLI? Yeah. Well, I'd say you probably need at least a 550-600. Got to have at least.
Yeah, well, there are people that have bought it and are running it right now on a 450-watt power supply.
Wow.
All right.
It's recommended to have a 600, and just like, you know, if you had two 460s, you were recommended to have 750-watt power supply. With the, just to show you the difference, the less power, less heat, the 600 cards, they have people running them off of 500-watt power supplies, and that's huge. That shows right there how much more efficient they are.
Oku in the chat is asking, are all these GPUs exactly the same size because he has a very tight case? Sounds like a problem there, Oak. No, I'm just kidding. But that's a very good question. They are not all the same size, especially like the 400 cards, I think. Well, the 275 that I had, because it was a 75 and it had a 5 at the end, that's some weird nomenclature that NVIDIA does. It was a monster card. And when I replaced it with my 560 Ti with 448 cores, then the 448 cores is much smaller. I was very surprised at how much smaller the 560 was compared to this 275 that I had before. So, no, they're not all the same size. When you do buy them, you should probably measure, like, the distance from, you know, where it's going to be towards your hard drive area or what have you in your PC.
But what you need to know is that everything, they have to follow certain rules, sizing rules. Mm-hmm. And I'll simplify it for Yoku and anybody else that's wondering if the graphics card will fit. You may have, like, a silly Dell PC and you want to upgrade the whatever, but that... They size the cases by ATX, or basically a micro ATX, ATX, and BTX. Mm-hmm. Those are your different sizes. All graphics cards are designed to fit in a ATX case. So if you have an ATX case, it's supposed to be at least 4.5 inches deep, at least. Some mm-hmm. of them are wider and taller. And it's supposed to be like 11.5 as far as the PCIe slot wide or the length of it to allow for the graphics card. So if you have an ATX case, or if you're not sure.
Oh, he has a micro ATX. That's why.
If you have a micro ATX case, you are in trouble. It's a lot of cards will not fit into micro ATX. Some micro ATX, cases, they're kind of like gaming cases. So they're modified a little bit, so like the hard drive, where you hold the hard drives are like adjusted so you can still fit a card. But micro ATX cases are not meant for gaming. And not only on top of that, anybody that has a micro ATX case, I will cry little tears for you because those things run hot.
Yeah.
There's no airflow in them. They're just bad all around. That poor processor in a micro ATX case, it's just everything all about it is bad. Go out and get yourself a Antec. Go out and get yourself any number of, $100, $120 cases, and you'll notice your temps drop by 20 Celsius or more, guaranteed.
So the other thing, if you're trying to be in the market for a graphics card, and what I kind of recommend, every time I do this, like for they had one naming convention or naming nomenclature for a long time when they were in like the 6,000, the 7,000, the 8,000 series. And then when they got to the 200s, they abandoned that and they started this brand new nomenclature. So to break it down, is from what I know, GTX represents enthusiast style cards. These are the cards that you as a gamer are going to want. GT are sort of like performance, midway, media computers. And if it just has like nothing at the end, it's like GTS. Or GTS is the, these cards are really for Farmville. they're not meant for gaming as we know it. So never ever get an NVIDIA GTS graphics card. GT is the minimum you want to get. I would recommend always get something that says GTX on it. And then the numerical system is 60 is sort of the minimum in terms of like you want to go if you're looking for a graphics card for gaming. And so 60 or higher, and then usually the 70 is like the next step up, which comes out maybe later or is a little bit more powerful. The 80 and the 90 are those like that are way out there, like super massive things shoved into this super power draw, and it get an extra 5%. Like it's not usually worth it to get an 80 or a 90 in the NVIDIA stage, but that could easily change. So do your homework every time you get a card. Read the reviews on Tom's Hardware, etc., etc. That's what I know, but I have to always like Google NVIDIA nomenclature and then read the Wikipedia article and find out what if I know what I know. But we're getting a little late, so let's try and finish this up very quickly. The only thing that you should be concerned about when getting a CPU, I think, Freelancer, your recommendation is an i5-2500K right now. That'll do pretty much anybody, right?
Yeah, stay as far as right now, here and now, stay away from an Ivy Bridge. I know Ivy Bridge, I was amping it up in Team Legacy forums, you know, about how great it was going to be. Turned out it completely sucks. It runs hotter than a Sandy Bridge, which has amazed everybody.
Because they said Hardware, it was going to be the opposite.
Yep. Tom's Hardware had a great review where they were just, you know, they hated to say it. Ivy Bridge just completely fell through. Now, what Ivy Bridge was great for was like laptops, because they added a GPU onto the Ivy Bridge. And that Ivy Bridge by itself, get this, can run StarCraft II at medium settings without any graphics card. I mean, that shows you what they did to, you know, to better the processor. But just, you know, the average person, they're not going to be running StarCraft II at medium settings and be happy at 20 FPS, you know. So in terms of the heat, it's hotter. You can't overclock it as much. Just that built-in GPU, the Intel 3000 they put on it, just completely is great for laptops. You know, great for mobile, but it's just not good for a desktop PC. Stick with the Sandy Bridge. There's a lot of good Sandy Bridges out, 3770s. There's the i5. Obviously, everybody knows about the i5, 2500K.
That's a good one to get because you can overclock it fairly easily.
Oh, yeah. So, I'm running an i5 2500K. I overclocked mine very easily to 5.2 gigahertz. It's not...
Using some very, you know... decent cooling systems, we should point out, not the stock stuff.
Nobody should be using stock anyway. I mean, you can get a decent, a Hyper 212 cooler. Go ahead and Google Hyper 212. It's the best cooler out there. The best part about it, what makes it so awesome, is not only is it the best at cooling, but it's only like $12. I mean, you can't beat that. And you can overclock if you're comfortable doing it. And Sandy Bridge is very easy to do it and get performance, 30-40% more performance out of it. At no risk, and I mean no risk, you know, whereas with the previous quad core processors that I'm sure many people listening still have, you know, overclocking those can be finicky and they can get very hot very fast, and it's always a rough scenario. But Sandy Bridge all the way, that's my pick.
All right, so let's see, where are we on the show notes here? Let's see, RAM, how much RAM do we need, Freelancer? 8 gig? Is that good?
No, the average person only needs about 4 gig.
4 gig.
It really depends. Are you streaming? Yes or no. If you're streaming, yes, 8 gig. If you are only hopping on to play Guild Wars 2 and other stuff we won't mention, then 4 gig. No, I'm just kidding. But typically you want to aim for 4 gig. That's just kind of the sweet spot for gamers.
And don't get 8 gig if you don't have a 64-bit OS installed. 8 gig will do you no good. Nothing over 4 gig will help you at all unless you have a 64-bit operating system set up. So if you still got your, you know, Windows Vista 32-bit installed on your computer, it might be time to upgrade.
Yeah. And in terms of 8 gig, 12 gig and stuff, it really is very strictly based on, are you frapsing? You know, are you recording? What is your upload rate? You know, if you're uploading at an incredible amount, it's going to be a lot more taxing on your CPU. You'll have to overclock it. You'll have to do that. We should do a streaming episode sometime.
I think we definitely could. Yeah, absolutely.
Kind of help people out with that.
So any other important features of RAM? I mean, back in the day, it was all about EEC. Timings are important. Anything that people should be looking out for? Is there a good guide out there that you know?
ECC RAM is server RAM. No desktop user would buy that. That's error correcting RAM.
Right.
That's another conversation. But no, with
not
RAM,
everybody
looks at speeds. Everybody looks at speeds. They see 800 megahertz. They see 1333, 1600 megahertz. And they immediately think, well, since it's 1600 megahertz, it must be incredibly faster. Like if I switch out my 800 megahertz with a 1600 megahertz, my games are going to run so much smoother. And they are so sadly mistaken when they realize that when they put that 1600 megahertz RAM in there, they maybe get 1 to 2% performance increase.
Is that because the bottleneck at that point is the bus that goes to the CPU, or?
No. It's just because RAM is not utilized in that way. It's people look at that speed and they just think that megahertz just makes it immediately better proportionally. You know, they think that 1600 megahertz RAM is going to be twice as fast as 800 megahertz RAM, and that's just not the way it works. The architecture is different. We'll go into that another day. But if you get 1600 megahertz RAM, great. But you're only going to get 1 to 2% performance increase getting that speed of RAM than if you got an 800 megahertz RAM. So get yourself, I would much rather see everybody get 8 gig of 800 megahertz RAM for about $60 to $70 than getting 4 gig of 1600 megahertz RAM is what I'm getting at.
All right. Aku's going to be getting out of here. Thanks for joining us, Aku. Sorry you have to go.
Thank you. No problem.
I know we're running way longer. It's like a 2-hour episode. Holy shit. But it's been a great discussion.
You got me started on computers. Shouldn't have done that.
I know. That's a mistake. So what about timing for RAM? Is that how important is timings? Everybody like 5-5-5 or 9-9? What's the deal? It's lower is better, right?
Timings is actually where you are going to notice the difference. When people overclock when they overclock, period, they just think processor and GPU, and there's a whole nother level of overclocking, and you can actually tweak your RAM to get tighter timings. For example, if you're running 1600 megahertz RAM, you could actually make it faster by bumping it down to 1333 and then increasing or lowering the timings to, let's say, from 777.15, for example. There's guides out there for all the RAM. It's very easy. It's not hard to follow. But
is there a minimum or a maximum for timing that you should be looking at? No more than like 999, or what's the deal?
This is one of those things that we couldn't possibly cover. It's different for every brand, every type of RAM.
Gotcha. Fair enough. Okay. And let's see what else is left on the notes here. Hard drives versus solid state drives, I guess. Do we need solid state drives for gaming?
You're asking the wrong person now.
All right. I don't think they're necessary. I'll put it out there. I think it's nice to have.
Let's make one thing clear. I'll summarize it real quick. Solid state drives are not going to make your game run faster.
Loading times only.
Yeah, big misconception is if I buy a solid state drive, which they have gone down in price quite a bit, that somehow my, you know, Guild Wars 2 is going to run better during World v. World, and that's completely false. If you have that mindset, throw it out. What solid state drives are is just quite literally, instead of a spinning platter, you have memory chips, meaning that when you're loading things, that's it, you're running a lot faster. We're talking incredibly faster, 100 times, 80 times faster than a hard drive. Now, all that means is loading times, you know, loading up Windows. My Windows boots up in 8 seconds flat from the time I press my power button down to the time I can log on to Skype and talk to you right now. And that's because I have SSDs. When I'm in Guild Wars 2, when I was in the public beta there was no loading screen. That's what SSDs do. I mean,
wait,
it really
how
was.
How did you learn how enter, to play?
Exactly. I enter a portal, it flashes, and I'm there. You know, and that's how it what SSDs will do. If that's your thing, great. You know, spend the money on it. But it is a luxury item. That's all it's going to do. Because as soon as I load into the game, I'm not any better off than somebody else that just has a regular hard drive.
All right. The last thing I think that we should cover here is motherboard. What should people look at in a motherboard besides branding? Obviously, you need to find a motherboard that works with your processor. So you need to know what, you can do some research on this too. Just do sort of, you know, processor. What do they call those? The like L1155. What is that? Yeah.
That's your socket.
Socket type. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, like you have the 1155s, 1156s right now, which are the current generation. Actually, yeah, that would be considered current gen for desktops. But no, you don't really have to concern yourself with that. I mean, just know it works with a certain processor. Anywhere you go, Newegg, Amazon will list processors it works with.
So just
the only thing you have to worry about with the motherboard is, like with you, Bridger, you and I both stream. We have a lot of people in chat that stream. If you are streaming and saving your data, your raw data, especially video, unencoded or uncompressed, to an external hard drive, one big thing you would be looking for is USB 3.0.
That's what I've got.
Exactly. And you're that's great. You know, you can actually transmit that data via your USB to the hard drive fast enough and be able to keep up. If you have USB 2.0, what you realize is you're losing frames because the bandwidth just can't keep up. So you're looking for USB 3.0, you're looking for PCI slots, you know. If you're not going to put two graphics cards in, two different cards in and run them in SLI, there are every board you're looking at, there is a version of it that only has one PCIe slot and will run you $50 cheaper. You just have to find.
It costs that much to have a second one, huh?
Absolutely. Wow. And there's some that people buy that have three slots. They'll spend $280 for the motherboard, and they'll only ever put one graphics card in it. And that's completely pointless. I mean, be smart about what you're shopping for. Realize what you need to buy. Besides that, SATA, 6 gig versus 3 gigabits per second, that goes into the SSDs we're talking about. If you're running just a regular hard drive, or maybe even if it's an upgraded hard drive, like a Barracuda or a Cheetah drive, it's still a disk platter. You're only going to need 3 gigabits per second, which any motherboard
would
say. Which
is SATA 2.0, is that right? And 3.0 is the 6 gigahertz?
That's
six gigabyte.
So now with the newer SSDs coming out, like the Vertex 4s and all these newer, the SandForce chipset, you can do a Google on what SandForce is, which was so horrible, is out the door. They have a new one that just came in. A lot of SSDs are moving over to it, and they take full advantage of the 6 gigabit interface. So if you're wanting to get a really good SSD, you want a motherboard that can support it, and make sure you're looking for a 6 gigabit per second SATA controller.
And I think lastly we should point out, and this isn't really, you know, something that is, you know, you have to do review checks and things like that. But when you buy a power supply for your computer, do not price of your power supply. There are plenty of power supplies out there that are selling for $30 and $40. That's a bad idea.
Let me jump in. Let's take a gander, Bridger. Why do you think a 600 watt, $50 power supply is so much worse than a, let's say, Corsair? Same wattage power supply for $50 more.
Well, the manufacturing quality of the pieces, I would guess, and the sort of tolerances various pieces in it.
Yeah, the key thing is we talked about overclocking. The difference between those two power supplies is the voltage, how steady it maintains itself. It's, you know, if you're overclocking, you want steady voltages. You know, if you're going to bump it up 0.125 V-core, which is the voltage setting if you go to overclock it, for the processor, you want to make sure that's stable. Cheap power supplies fluctuate like crazy, and your motherboard will compensate for it. That's what the capacitors and the resistors are for. It'll absorb it, you know, any spikes and drops in voltage, but you don't want your motherboard to be taxed like that. Mm-hmm. You know, you want a good power supply that gives out a steady voltage to your processor, that when you overclock it and such, your motherboard doesn't have to compensate for the bad voltage, or what we just call bad power altogether. Mm-hmm. That's all there is to it. I mean, that will answer 90% of everybody's question of why a cheap power supply won't work. If you're not overclocking, it still matters, because your motherboard is taking hit after hit every time you get a little power surge, whereas a good power supply will do that for you, and it won't hurt the motherboard or processor.
All right. I think that's probably the last thing on my list. Anything else that any of you guys wanted to add to this discussion on hardware? Did we miss anything?
Giga, Vega, you guys got any curiosities?
My head hurts from all this information.
I could go for hours.
Knowledge!
I have my energy drink. I could talk computers for days and days.
All right. Anybody in the chat room have any very quick, you know, did we miss anything? Is there something that was confusing? I just want, because we had a lot of stuff we just dropped in this episode. I don't want anything to go, you know, that could have a simple answer to go unanswered if we have it here.
This is for Guild Wars 2 players out there, because you guys are going to get into the game. A lot of you are realizing now you need to upgrade, and you're going to have to bite the bullet eventually, because you're going to want to do World v. World. I'm telling you right now.
Well, HK Ravenflame asks, why would I want a separate power supply? All power supplies are separate. There's no power supply that's built into a motherboard or anything like that.
No. Cases what he's come probably getting at is that there are PCs, I've built one before, that have two power supplies. And that's for people that are pushing benchmarks. That's not for anybody that is building a gaming PC. They actually bridge, or you'll find PCs out there that have two separate power supplies, one for just the graphics cards and the hard drives, and one just for the processor.
They're probably playing with Maya on those.
They're doing number crunching, they're
six pulling, hard drives,
doing the cancer research and all that fun stuff.
All right, so I think then that about wraps it up here, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in, however you're getting this, YouTube, on the podcast feed, which, by the way, if you do want to get that, it's available on the website, talesoftyria.com, on the right-hand side.
Just throwing in one last time, if you guys want to debate for hours about how you're going to spend your $1,000 or whatever, that's what our Team Legacy Forum, that Bridger linked in the show notes, is for. I will go there and talk with you for days and days and give you walls of text, and you will know twice as much about computers as you ever thought you would.
Because he is a computer, as you can tell by his Cyloning. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the question of the week this week, ATI or NVIDIA? Which one's better? Come to our hardware forum and tell us why one is better than the other. We're looking forward to it. I have been Bridger. This has been my guest, Freelancer, Gigawatt, Aku, and Vega. Thank you guys for tuning in. If you really enjoyed the show, tell somebody about it, won't you? TalesofTyria.com. Have a good night. We should all end the show sitting like a Jarl. Wait, we already did that once, didn't we? I think we did that when Skyrim came out. All right. That was a good show. Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
We knocked out hardware once and for all, so that'll be it.
Hopefully.
No more talk about hardware. Nothing but Guild Wars 2, because public beta is next week. Hint, hint, right?
Hopefully.
Right?
Yeah. I don't know. You think they're going to have it on Memorial Day weekend? They're going to actually... Memorial Day weekend?
I don't. I hope not. I hope not. Because I already got plans to go somewhere without my computer.
This is what I'm hearing, okay, from my guild members, is they said they would have one a month, but then the other half are saying it's Memorial Day. They're not doing it.
Well, no. They very specifically said, there was a tweet that clarified, we said that we would have one roughly every month, and that is subject to change. That is not a guarantee.
There's that little fine print there.
I know I saw a tweet that specifically was trying to clarify, we cannot guarantee one every month. We are going. Our plan is one a month, roughly. But they left room, wiggle room, just in case they were not going to be able to make it. And Memorial Day weekend seems like a situation where you might just lose out. But maybe we'll get two in June. Cross your fingers.
Yeah. Several people asking about surge protectors. Any basic surge protector is fine. As long as it has a little over 1,000 joules protection, though you'll see on every surge protector, it rates it by joules. Get something with at least 1,000, you'll be plenty fine. No reason to spend a ton of money on that. And no, a surge protector does not protect against lightning strikes. I am so freaking tired of people saying...
But it protects against surges, Freelancer.
That's just a really big surge.
I've been an electrician for the last 7 years. I still have my license. And I still hear it once a week, people that have their surge protectors blow out or whatever is connected to them blow out, and they're like, it was supposed to protect against the lightning. And I just facepalm every time. Inside I facepalm, because I can't insult them, you know, because that's how they're
raised.
Because
that's the client. That's what we call...
Well, you could insult them down there.
That's what we have called in the AV industry. We call that an ID10T error. And I'll spell this out for the client, for the chat room. ID10T. So maybe you'll get it if you look at it there, if you write it down. But if somebody, we get a call like, hey, somebody needs assistance. Whoa. If somebody needs assistance getting on the internet in, you know, Capital Room, whatever, I go down there, and then I get on the radio and I go back. It's okay. It was just an ID10T error, because I can safely say that. It's like PepCat.
Mr. Classes, what if you had 10 surge protectors to each other? You could have a 500 surge protection.
You'd need a circuit breaker.
No, that wouldn't protect. No,
that wouldn't protect it either.
Don't get it. No, it would not.
It's just too much in the single burst.
There are lightning arresters that you can get. There are surge arresters.
Lightning arresters. I need one of those for my elementalist.
If you want to spend $20,000 and you own a business, you can get lightning arresters, but If a lightning, if someone somewhere decides they want to hit your house with a lightning strike and it wants to go through your outlet and wherever the heck it needs to get to ground closest, which is what it's going to do, it doesn't matter how many surge protectors are in the way. Everything's fried along the way. You can forget it. I mean,
1.21 gigawatts.
Yes. I actually did have lightning strike a tree out in the front yard, and it went along the car and completely destroyed the car electronically, and then into the wall of the garage room that converted into a room, killed everything on that side of the room, and all the computers on that side of the room too, like, went, traveled all the way around, wiped out the entire room. Like,
wow.
It's just too strong.
All right.
Nerf lightning.
Got hit by lightning.
All right, let's close it out here. I think iDrops is and the rest of the people are chomping at the bit to play some League here. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be casting tonight. I'm just wiped out. I went to a wedding last night, and then the day before I was board gaming. Today I was board gaming. I spent the rest of the day trying to get my stupid green screen to work, and it's not working. You would think that it's a green screen. It should just work, but it doesn't actually. So anyway, I'm going to log off here. I might play in the in-house or something. I might play something else. I don't know. I'm just going to be going to bed early tonight. That's all I know. I need some sleep. All right.
Talk to you guys later.
See you later in the chat room. Thanks for watching. Next week, 8 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Check out iDrops channel, which is twitch.tv/ the letter I, DROPS.